Okay, we're good to go. And keep in mind, the only practice that really works is everyday practice. That's the only practice that actually works. And the other ones may hold out like a rainbow, like, oh, but no, the everyday practice is the one that actually works. It really works. But who wants to really succeed is the question. Not right? So what is foremost on everyone's mind? Well, their own happiness. How can we find happiness? And there's two different beliefs about this. We call it the ego and the Holy Spirit. This is a way of delineating the two different ways. And the ego says if we're all miserable, then no one's miserable. That's the ego's logic. Okay, if we're all miserable, if we're equally, we're all miserable, and no one's miserable. Great. Yeah, so the Holy Spirit tells us we've never not been miserable. We've never been miserable at all. We've never been miserable at all. Nothing's ever been miserable. So it's like, wow, quite a difference between those two, right? There is no misery. The Holy Spirit will show us that there's no such thing as misery. It's just convention. It's all it is. All suffering is mere convention. There is no suffering at all. Okay, now, so you look between these two viewpoints, you say, whoa, they're both so extreme, right? Can we not find something? Those are the only two viewpoints there are. The Holy Spirit says there's never been any suffering. And the ego says that let's make suffering, if we all suffer, we'll make suffering real. And what is real has to be happy. You see, whatever's real feels right to you. So, you'll feel right if we all suffer. There's a certain kind of complete twisted logic to that, you see. Now, so we're jumping right into this, okay? And we need to jump into it. What is this? The 12th, I think, of July. 12 more days to the 24th. So we are virtually there. I just was reminded something quite extraordinary. We had this experience one time. What was maybe the most extraordinary experience of my life, where we were at the beach. It was miserable and foggy and cold and spray of the ocean, and it was, you said, we got to get out of here. We're just no hope for this to ever get better. It's miserable. And suddenly it popped into our minds to say, wait 15 minutes, wait 15 minutes. And I said, okay, well, what the heck? What's the use? Why not? We're here. Might as well wait 15 minutes. And this is when suddenly this trickle of a soft little breeze came trickling through, like a little tiny trickle of water, kind of a little breeze. And it was this warm breeze. And it kind of just, and then it sort of calmed down a little bit. And then another little trickle came through. And then another little trickle. I said, "Wow, what in the world is this?" And then gradually, this little trickle turned into a little stream of warm air. And then that stream of warm air turned into a river of warm air. And then this massive, mighty river of warm air came in, and it absolutely pushed out all of the dark, gloomy, hideous clouds that were blocking the sun and the nasty air and everything. And everything was sparkling like a jewel. And the atmosphere was just jewel-like. And everyone on the beach was just, we could hardly believe what had happened. I've been at the beach so many times. Nothing like this has ever happened. I mean, how it happened, it was just the most amazing experience. And this stuck with me to this day, saying, wait 15 minutes. You think it's real bad. You think you're finished. No hope. This is a feeling that we had no hope. I said, it's hopeless here. It's hopeless. Well, meaning it wasn't going to get any better. And then miraculously, the whole thing turned around miraculously. And it became this the best atmosphere I've ever experienced. I think it was just, we were laughing. And we just, you jumping and laughing. Oh my gosh, this is unbelievable. The sun was sparkling like a diamond in the sky, whereas before it was all obscured and looked harsh and cold. And just the most amazing transformation I've ever experienced. Now, 15. So always I say, wait 15 minutes. What does that mean? Wait 15. Well, it suddenly popped into my mind just before taping that Jesus returned at the end of April, okay, like about April 29th of last year, something like that. Okay, now, if you go a full year to April 29th, that's 12 months, then you go, yeah, May 29th is 13, June 29th is 14, July 29th is 15. 15 months. Wait 15 minutes. And then the miraculous salvation from dismal despair. I just so just to hear that, because I say that the week of the 24th, 28, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, so that's 6 days. It's starting on the 24th of July through the 29th, something like that. There's going to be some sort of situation, either subtle or overt or both. And I'll talk about this in the video. Okay, so this is setting the stage for what is coming within 12 days now. And the reminder, suddenly the Holy Spirit reminded me, remember the 15, wait 15 minutes? Well, and because I was thinking, I'm not posting to Jesus has returned about what Jesus, so much about what's going on, because I haven't had any direct contact with Jesus for now it's been 14 months plus. And I'm not making it up, because if I was, I'd be making up, oh yeah, this. And I'm saying, I haven't had any contact, so what could I say about, directly? I say a few things about the impression I'm getting about stuff, but as far as direct contact, no, I have not. I have not. So I'm saying, Jesus, what in the world's going on? Then wait 15 minutes. Wait 15 minutes, and then you'll see. Now, I believe that people are watching this video from all over the world. I understand this. So I'm taping this in California, the mighty California, in the mighty USA. California, if it was a country, it'd be the fifth most prosperous country in the world, the fifth greatest GNP in the world. So it's a mighty, mighty state, to say the least. And we have this, of course, election coming up. And I usually don't talk too much about politics, but we're getting up to the 12 days away from the convention. The conventions are coming very soon, actually. First the Republican convention, then the Democratic convention. 24th, I think, is right in the middle between the two of them. So I think, I don't know, the Republican convention might start the 18th or something. Or I mean, it's really, really soon, very soon. So this is when it really heats up here. Now, we're talking about your happiness. What's the most important thing? Your happiness, right? We all want to be happy. What is it that keeps us from this happiness? And what it is that it's our continuity fear. And our continuity fear doesn't want to see that all of existence is just a mere convention. That's all that it is. It wants to see that some of it's a convention and some of it's real. We're afraid to see it all as a mere convention, actually. That existence has never existed. That there was time has never existed. We want there to be a little bit of time. So we get rid of a lot of it, but keep a little bit. This is what causes our failure. And the continuity fear keeps feeding this. We keep turning back to this belief and try to keep pursuing this compromise between truth and lies, as if there were something other than truth and lies. I mean, there's something, there's either truth or denial of truth. There's not something else. There's not a partial denial of truth. Okay, this is what Jesus tells us. There's not a partial denial of truth. If you deny truth in any regard, it's a total denial of truth. So there isn't any partial denial of truth. But we keep pursuing this partial denial of truth, or what we call partial acceptance of truth, to try to put a positive spin on it. That's really a partial denial of truth. And so we fail. So the characteristics I've seen here of all of us in history, and all of my contemporaries here, which is everyone here right now, is to try and fail, try and fail, try and fail. Oh, I only almost reached it. I just gave a little denial of truth. Oh, but it didn't work. God doesn't love me. God must hate me, or something wrong with for me. It's, that should have worked. I only denied truth a little bit, So fail. Fail. We stall out. Just before we reach the success, we stall out. Some stall out right away, but others seem to go a ways, and oh, I'm almost successful. Oh, but I just failed. I stalled out just before I succeeded. This is what happens. And indeed, this happens life after life after life after life after life. We pursue this, a little denial of truth, and we stall out, and we don't quite realize the truth, and we have another life, and this just goes on and on and on and on and on and on. This is all that happens here. So to avoid unhappiness, you have to avoid the stall out. You have to avoid stalling out. Okay? So far, pretty simple, right? It's not rocket science here, actually. It's quite simple. But continuity fear says, I don't know. Okay, fine. Just notice that fear that's throwing up, and just bless it and say thank you for being here. Don't try to crush it. Don't try to drive it away. Don't try to do anything with it. Just notice it and say, this is continuity fear. Fine. This is what we're evaporating. So we'll just keep working on evaporating that. It's not your enemy. You're not fighting with it. You're not arguing with it. You just say, okay, I have continuity fear, and that gives rise to all this. Stall out, right? Yeah. It stalls us out. Okay? Fine. Now, what we are facing in the world right now is a potential for a great collective stall out. A very severe stall out. And what does the ego stall us out into? Well, if we're all miserable, then that means misery must be real. Therefore, it's not a problem for us, because reality, we say reality is not a problem for us. So if we make illusions true, we say, well, then we don't have any problem. Illusions are true, and so we must be happy with them. So if we're all miserable, then misery must be true, and we like truth. Okay. So the ego is kind of using this very peculiar, weird logic. Like, we love truth, so if we make misery true, then we'll love misery. You got that? This is how the ego, it's its logic. So, we love truth. If we can make misery true, we'll love misery. So let's, very simple. A lot of bugs flying around. It's okay. Isn't that simple? This is the ego. This is how the ego views us and our destiny. Is our destiny is to be happy, the ego says. Your destiny is to be happy. And the way to be happy, the ego says, is to be miserable. And make everyone miserable. And when everyone's miserable, then misery, that will magically make misery real. Because if everyone's experiencing the same thing, the ego says, well, it must be real. Right? So if we're all miserable, we think that makes misery real. And we love reality. So we now love misery. Problem solved. According to the ego, problem solved. And so this is very seductive, this logic. And so we stall out into what? Into misery. We're all miserable here already. We're all chronically depressed, chronic despair. We're all maniacs here. The whole world is nothing but maniacs, actually. And because we're stalling out and pursuing this misery, actually, this convention, it's just a convention. There is no misery, actually. It's just a convention as a way to believe that it's possible that we could change reality. So, I've said that there's a strong potential in the world for a great global collective stall out right now. Very strong. And the stall out is towards everyone being miserable, believing that this will produce happiness. So you would best be alert here to this, okay? This is a high, high alert. We've been on a high alert for a long time, because this has been coming and coming and coming and coming and coming like a terrible storm. So recognize what the ego's belief system is all about. You love reality, we make misery real, we love misery. That's simple. And there's a very simple and clear way of seeing it. That means you're headed towards misery if you stall out. Okay. A stall out means you just say, oh, I failed. I can't be liberated. There's something wrong somewhere. I don't know what it is. And then you turn to misery and to the ego's advice. You stalled out. You've turned to the ego. And you know, you've ended your spiritual efforts. You just feel like you can't. Something's wrong. I can't do it. Blah, blah, blah. So collectively, there's a great collective global stall out. That means everyone on the planet feels this way. So the reinforcement is very intense. Too intense. Now, is there anything we can do about this? Is the question. Right, so can we shift to this question? If we're ready to shift to this question, if you're if we're together so far, and it's pretty simple, right? There's a potential for collective stop, because there are many, many, many in this world that believe in the ego's logic, that if we just make illusions real, then we'll love illusions, and so there's no problem at all. If we just make suffering real, then we'll love suffering, and it's no problem. They believe in the ego's logic. So many in this world now are that way. And you say, no problem, no problem. no problem. Yeah, okay. But that's the ego's way of saying no problem. Meaning that we're going towards no problem. Whereas the Holy Spirit says there's no problem right now. There's never been any problem. So how can you make problems real? There's never been a single problem ever. Never been a single problem ever. Now you hear this and you say, wow, what is this? This is called non-dual truth, the truth as it isness. This is actually reality as it isness, free of these fake conventions that we've tried to view it through. Pretend that this is what we're seeing. We're seeing what's not here. As it isness, this is just expression. As it isness, just saying, you know, as it is as it is. There's never been any problem at all. So how do we make what doesn't exist real? It's ridiculous. You can't. There's never been a problem, so how can we make problems real and then we'll all be happy by making them real? This is the delusion of the ego. So there's this as it isness is simply reality, and there's some in the world that have expressed this as it isness and been the presence of it here in the world, and they're quite notable because it's just wow, you know, it's just like, it's astonishing. And we call them here, we call them the Dharma Kings. It's just a nice catchy phrase. We could call them the Gospel Kings also. The Gospel Kings, meaning the Good News Kings. We could say that Ramana is a Gospel King. Jesus is a Gospel King. Gospel means good news. Dharma really means good news as well. The good news. You could say it protects the good news in the world. The pragmatic action aspect is to make sure the good news is being heard in the world or is present in the world. That's what the Dharma is all about. You hear about these Dharma protectors or gospel protectors. The idea is they're doing everything they can do to make sure that this good news is present in the world here, okay, among us maniacs. Now, why would they be doing that? Okay, so now we're starting to really look at something here that's very important to us. So keep your attention on high alert here. You should be on high alert right now, because the world is really, really headed for a collective stall out. Potentially. It is very strong potential for that. Now, I'm sitting outside here. And let's say there's somebody barbecuing down the block somewhere, all right? Half a mile down the block, whatever. So I'm sitting here and we're talking, and then suddenly, just for a moment, what's that? I thought I smelled something. No. I said, no, I don't know. Then a little while later, There's that smell again. Maybe there is something. What? I wonder what that is. And gradually you start thinking, huh, that smell reminds me of something, you know. Where's it coming from? I don't know. I don't see anything. Well, it's coming from that barbecue down the street. And, you know, they're, the smoke is building up from the barbecue, and it diffuses in the air, and it spreads throughout the neighborhood. And people from all over the neighborhood are smelling that barbecue, faintly. But there's something intense about the barbecue, right? That just even a faint smell of the barbecue, that reminds you of what? Food. You know, delicious food. Barbecue, okay. If you're into barbecue. But you get the point. There's some odors that diffuse so well, and that they keep the capacity for us to smell it extends, you know, far and wide from the origin, far and wide. Maybe it's the charcoal briquettes and whatever's cooking, the steak and charcoal briquettes, whatever it is. Somehow, it really, you could smell it from far away. And so everyone is reminded of, good food, abundant food, or, you know, okay. So this is an analogy that we're using for the gospel kings, the Dharma kings. Let's, for instance, Jesus Christ. He's in the world. His presence is here. The as it isness is present and expressing itself. There's never been any problem at all. There's never been any illusion. Nothing's ever happened. Everything's perfect. Everything is as it is. So this diffuses out this adamant expression and presence of truth as it isness here, free of all these false conventions, diffuses out like a subtle emanation of truth in the world, like fragrance from a barbecue. Jesus is this massive barbecue, and it diffuses out everywhere, and we smell a little, we get a little whiff of it. We hear something that Jesus said or he did or something. We say, huh, that reminds me of something. What does that remind me of? Something, there's something to this. I just can't quite remember what, just not sure what it is. Now, you get other Dharma kings, gospel kings, and similar thing, right? They're having their barbecue, and they're barbecuing over here, and they're barbecuing over there, and the neighbors over there, barbecue. So you got all these barbecues going around the neighborhood, around the world, and people say, there's this really nice smell, you know. It's just, it makes me feel good. There's something in the air, we call it. You know, something in the air that just makes me feel good. I just feel kind of in this mood of sort of contemplation and remembrance. Okay, well, so this is how it works in the world. Is there is this subtle diffusion in the mind stream of all of us maniacs here that remind us of truth. They remind us of truth as it isness. And so when we start to stall out and say, I'm done, I'm finished, I quit. Let's do what the ego wants us to do. Let's all stall out into collective misery here. There's something in us that says, whoa, I'm not sure about that. Quite sure about that. I'm not really convinced, you know. I don't know if I really need to stall out or not. Okay. There's something, and it's sort of on that level, like I'm not sure that stalling out is that's the right thing, but I don't know why. It's just kind of a vague feeling I have. That's pretty much how it is for almost everyone here in the world, all us maniacs here, is we have just sort of something in us that's kind of telling us, like, I don't think we really want to go down that road of the egos telling us this. I don't know why I feel this way. You know, the ego seems so logical and assured and confident that it really has the answer for us. But it seems like something else is just sort of nagging me. You know, I'm not sure. Okay, so you get this. So when you have that in the world, you don't quite stall out collectively. Individually, you have stall outs and such, but there isn't this super collective stall out because people are saying, nah, not quite, not yet. I'm not quite ready for that yet. Maybe later, but not quite yet. Like, it's like that, not quite yet. And so the world continues on without this vast collective stall out, which is so ruinous. Well, for as far as setting us, knocking our momentum out and, you know, really going into a dark, 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 dark place in our mind, so to speak, convention, very dark convention in our mental convention. So it prevents this collective stall out. Hey, hallelujah, how about that? So the purpose of these Dharma kings and gospel kings is to prevent this collective stall out from taking place, because we have a tendency towards that, because the continuity fear keeps compounding, and we keep compounding the situation. Compounding gets worse and worse, and it spirals down. It's like a vicious circle, a vicious cycle, and we cycle downwards towards this collective stall out. We keep thinking maybe that's the answer. Yeah, maybe we all stall out together. Maybe that's the answer. So this reflects in politics. It reflects this attitude gets reflected in our political leaders, the people we look to for hope, you know, help in the world, help and happiness. We're looking to them for happiness, really. And they say, yeah, we know the way. You know, which, so when we're getting ready for collective style, this is reflected in who we think is going to really bring us happiness. But it's just the ego. And we know what the ego believes our happiness comes from, is if we're all stuck in, eternally stuck in misery. Which, if we're eternally stuck in misery, the ego says, well, it must be real then. So, and you love reality, so you must love this. Again, problem solved, according to the ego. But what I discovered is what you really end up with is mental chaos. And you cannot tolerate that. So, problem not solved by the ego. And the ego doesn't have anything else. That's it. I realized the ego cannot solve our problem, or resolve our happiness issue at all. It doesn't have the answer for us. So then you have to say, well, what does have the answer? Wow. So what we are headed for is a potential collective stall out. This is what Jesus told us, that this in this time, in the end of this age, which is right now, there would be the worst collective stall out in history take place. Okay. This is why he's back. However, you know, not so fast here, not so fast yet. We're not going to call it that way yet, you see, because now there, the 20th century was, if you look at it, for like history of warfare, there was more wars in the 20th century than any time in history. It was the most incredibly destructive time in history because of all the weaponry, advanced weaponry and stuff. It's just unbelievable, the number of conflicts that took place in the 20th century. So you might say that we really started going to a very bad collective stall out in the 20th century, extremely bad. And there's the potential for atomic war and destruction of the ecosystem and the planet and annihilation of all of us here. Very strong. It almost happened. And what happens? Well, in 1890s, from 1870 through 1890, there's these great Dharma kings are born. And they live during the 20th century. And we know some of them. We know Rama Maharshi. I think he was born in 1879. I'm not sure, but he lived till 1950, so half the 20th century. You had Jamyang Kyentse Choki Lodro, born in 1893, living to 1959. You had Sri Sri Anandamoyi Ma, born in 1896, living to 1896 to 1982. All right, and then you had others like Punja Ji, for instance, and Srinivasagada Maharaj, and then you can talk about other Tibetans and, you know, Indians and who knows who, you know, who you can talk about as far as there was quite a few. Krishnamurti was certainly here. So you had an enormous number of extremely potent as it isness presence in a very potent way, maybe the most we've ever had in a small period of time. I don't know, it was quite extraordinary. And the purpose of that was to prevent this collective stall out from happening. So people in their consciousness here, us maniacs in our consciousness here, would say, I really feel like stalling out, but there's for some reason I'm not quite ready to do it yet. Something is kind of, I say, I want to just kind of want to just evaluate one more time. I kind of want to, there's something I still need to, you know, look at here, so I'm not quite ready. Well, it was the presence of these Dharma kings that brought that about, and nothing other than that, actually. Nothing other than that. If they had not have shown up, we would have stalled out, collectively stalled out. Okay? So in other words, we were saved by the grace of God, is what happened. Most certainly, we were. So what I'm getting to is it's only the presence of these Dharma kings in the world that prevents a collective stall out. That's it. If they're not here, we will stall out, collectively stall out. This is why it is so important to make sure that the good news continues to be present in the world. It is so important. It's all important. It's the only thing that throughout history has prevented us having this terrible collective stall out. So this is what I saw today. It's literally these heavyweights are the only thing between us and just a really horrible, horrible, horrible darkness and confusion in our minds. If we turn to the ego collectively, that's what we'll get. But if we put off the ego, says, no, I'm not quite ready for that. Yeah, ego, I think you're right, but I'm for some reason I'm not quite ready. I'm almost ready, but not quite ready. You put the ego off. You put the ego off. And that only comes because of the fragrance of truth in the world here. You say, well, there's some fragrance that's reminding me something of it. And I smell it here, so I'm just thinking where. I just want to find out where that's coming from. You know, it's just sort of, it's very vague and diffuse for most of us. Now, if you really are keen about it, you'll start trying to trace it back and find out where it's coming from, which is what I've done. I said, I want to find that barbecue. Where's the party here? And then, you know, like a bloodhound, you got a good nose, you follow it back, and you say, oh my gosh, it's coming from Ramana, you know, it's coming from Sri Sri Anamayama, it's coming from Jamyong Kensi Choki Lodro, it's coming from these various, you know, wonderful, wonderful lineages, and it's coming from the Nyingma masters, it's coming from the non-dualists, it's coming from this. But they have this as it isness, they abide as it is, not as something discovering it, but as it. You don't have the experience of being. You are the being. So they are the beingness. They are the isness. There's no separation of someone having that experience. They are it. They are it. As we all are, actually. So what they tell us is quite different than what the gradualist approach tells us. And so there's quite a difference there, actually. In Tibetan Buddhism, there's a differentiation between Trekcho and Togal, or Togal. Trekcho is like seeing illusion as illusion something, but Togal is actually being the truth. It's actually abidance. There's a differentiation,
And so the highest viewpoint is really the only viewpoint. It's the viewpoint-free viewpoint, actually, you could say. No viewpoint. Because you are it. You're not something viewing truth. You are the truth. So it seems just like a subtle thing to us, but it's not subtle at all. It's all important. Because one is still trying to purify, the other realizes that you could say everything is always pure from the beginning, but you wouldn't even say that because there's nothing, there's no such thing as impurity. So there's no even concept of purity at all. There's nothing to resolve. There's nothing to purify. There never has been the slightest thing to resolve or purify ever. This is how this is what they know to be true. This is the truth. Everything other than that is just a mere convention on our part, a mental convention, just a trick, a little habit we have to try and promote the idea that there's a separate reality. That's the reason why we have these silly conventions. There's no separate reality. So how could there anything need to be purified? There's only just one reality, and no contamination could ever take place. So it's a different. It's different, isn't it? As it is, this is different than these other religious approaches, which really, I have to say, are conventions themselves to make it put on a big show of try, 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 and really progress, 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 and then at the end stall out. It's like almost getting to the top of the mountain and then, I can't quite make it. That's a convention, too. In fact, this is a very clever convention that we have. So, and the ego has to accommodate our love of truth. So the ego says, sure, I love truth too, the ego says. And so here you go, this will help you towards truth. But it's designed from the very beginning to bring you up short and stall out. These graduated purification approaches. We got to purify, purify, defeat, defeat, purify, purify. All of that, those are just mere convention. There's no truth to that at all. Nothing needs to be purified. Nothing's impure. It's impossible. All of that are conventions, and very tricky because they're designed to fail from the very beginning. They're designed to fail. They're designed to stall you out. So you think you almost made it, but not quite. And you say, wow, I guess truth really isn't true. So what the ego wants you to do is you wants you to try but fail. And then when you fail, then you get real upset and frustrated and you say, ah, the ego was right. That there isn't any truth like that at all, huh? So the ego supports all sorts of efforts, but it's designed to fail. So the ego says, sure, go ahead and try this out. Yeah, hopefully it'll work for you. And it doesn't work, and the ego says, gee, that's too bad. So I guess I guess you just that's not the right direction to go in. But guess what? I have the right direction. And let's make illusions true, and then we'll love illusions. So indeed, the ego does sponsor all of this gradualism. You have to see it that way. Which is kind of like, wow, right? Yeah. But it seems safety to us. Safety. I want to come up short. I want to come up short. I want to fail. I want to fail. Yeah. I'm not used to. What do you mean? There's no time. There's no existence. There's nothing. They're just mere conventions. They're conventions. We have all these conventions. But what they're pointing to isn't there at all, which means they're pointing to what's not here, and everything's here. So they're not pointing to anything at all, really. They just say, oh yeah, the conventions ultimately point to nothing at all. How can we find nothing at all, right? So there's a great difference between these Dharma kings and the others on the spiritual path of different types of realizations. They think they've had realizations and stuff, but those realizations themselves are conventions. Egoic conventions that okay, this is it. Okay, great. And they can be full of spiritual words and phrases and beliefs and concepts and all this stuff. You can see very, very spiritual. But it's designed to come up short of the real acidicness, designed to come up short, to stall us out, stall out by design. This is how clever we are. We're very clever. We desired creativity to give us this experience of what's not here, and so we very clever, very creatively have designed to make it seem plausible that if we just work at it, that's there to be seen, that what's not here is here to be seen. The not here is here to be seen, but we just can't quite see it yet. So everything we're looking at is just here-ness, here-now-ness. But what we're looking for is what's not here. Okay, so this is the amazingly simple shift that we're talking about. Gotta be cool now. Power shift, here we go. Is we're already enlightened. Everyone's already enlightened. But we're trying to see, you know, what's not here now. We're all experiencing what's here now, here nowness. All of us. Always have. Our whole life. We've done nothing but experienced here nowness. Every single one of us. So not one of us has left reality at all. We're all still completely enlightened, still perfect, and have never experienced anything other than that. But we've been, you know, looking to see, to find what's not here now, what's not here right now, what's not here now. And so it's like we're just overlooking, you know, as it were, what's here now. Not that we're seeing something else, but we're searching, you know, it's just, you know, maybe it's here, maybe it's there, maybe they know, maybe they're seeing it, I don't know, right, what's not here now. It's that simple. It's really that simple. And so we can wow this a little bit. This is a wow for me because I'm seeing it more clearly now. So all we have to do is just stop the search for what's not here now. That's it. As Poonjaji said, call off the search. That's all you have to do. As any of us, we're already constantly experiencing what is now. And so our entire life, we've just been saturated with the here-nowness. Nothing other than that. Which is why all regrets can vanish in an instant for us. As soon as we see that, we realize we never had any real regrets at all. None of the regrets we had any reality to them whatsoever. They never arose at all. As we were just searching for regrets, actually. We never actually found them at all. No one's ever found any regret at all. So when we make this slight shift, then you can see all your regrets you're redeemed from every regret. And in Christianity, they are called sins. Missing the mark. I have this regret. I feel sinful. I'm not getting it somehow. I'm not finding it, you know. Well, that's because we're looking for what's not here now. Everything is always here now. So, of course, we can't find it. And so when we see that there's nothing to find, then all the regrets of not finding it, vanish. This now in Christianity, you say, you know, your sins were washed away. Baptized, you were born again. All your sins, this feeling that of regret, all this regret. If you look into your life, it's full of nothing but regrets in so many ways. All of that is vanished, is gone, just like that. They call it saved by the blood of the Lamb. If you want to get into that symbology, which goes back into Judaism. Meaning the suffering of these regrets, and somehow it passes you over because you have the tradition was to put blood of a lamb on the doors in Egypt, and the plagues and all the terrible things didn't touch them. You know, Pharaoh didn't sacrifice their children. There was protection from regret. So they called Jesus the Lamb, and the tradition was to use the blood of the Lamb to protect themselves from that. It was just some kind of tradition that they had for some reason. So they viewed Jesus as he's the super Lamb, the ultimate Lamb, meaning if you put the blood of Jesus on your house, but this there's some talking symbolically here. Then if you put the blood of Jesus on your psyche, then none of these regrets will touch you at all, and you'll feel completely free of regrets. So this is a symbolic external way of talking about what actually happens when you make this shift, where you realize that you've never been separate from here nowness, and you've never experienced anything other than it. No one has. Then your sins are washed away by this realization. So of course Christianity has had many, many saints who've had their sins washed away. People have experienced this. They've had experiences of it, but then they can come back on them if they don't really abide in it. But you can have this experience of being suddenly released from all your regrets. And it's like they never happened. They never happened. In fact, they never did happen. But the Dharma kings are in this state continuously of no regrets, because they realize that no regrets can happen at all. So they're continuously in this way, and this is what you call the great saints like this. Certainly there have been, Christianity's had a lot of this, people believe in Jesus, meaning Jesus is this here-nowness. What they refer to here-nowness is Jesus. As it isness. And when they see there's only Jesus, there's only as it isness, for some reason they personified it, which is a habit we've had. The maniacs here, we tend to personify what is really completely abstract. Okay, it's completely abstract, but until we're able to see that, then we end up personifying it. So you put it, personify it as Jesus. This here-nowness, it's always been what's always present. It's always present as this here-nowness. So we've never been separate from it. Nothing has ever been separate from it. We haven't been wandering in darkness at all. We don't need to be redeemed from darkness at all. We were never there. It's seeing that we were never there, which washes all the regrets away. You realize they never happened. It's not that you purify them, or transform them, or anything like that, really. Now you can symbolize it as a transformation, and they'll turn to flower petals or something, but that's just mental symbology. What you really see is that they never existed in the first place. They never happened. Nothing ever happened. Is what the non-dualists often say. The realization eventually dawns upon you that nothing ever happened. Nothing ever happened. Now, again, let's get back to what's foremost on your mind, which is your happiness. And you're saying, well, I can't quite understand this. Okay. But I feel something. If something tells me, yeah, this is right, but it's just vague. It's vague. Okay. So let's talk to that, because this is pragmatically what happens to all of us maniacs here. It's vague, it's fuzzy, I just can't quite bring that into focus. Everybody suffers from this. Until they don't suffer from it. Okay? It's like that. Now, example. Ramaharshi. I've been aware of Ramaharshi most of my life. My dad was certainly aware of him. He was very, very, very highly thought of. Even back in the 50s, The Razor's Edge by Somerset Maugham was my dad's favorite books. I think it had to do with Ramaharshi. The various books are written about him. And he was in his fragrance, his spiritual fragrance was in the world, really. It really was. And people who had gone to see him wrote books about him, and people read those books, and they said, there's something, I feel it's smelling something, something's in the air, you know, I don't, maybe it's this, you know, and they're thinking, maybe. So I've been aware of Ramaharshi basically my whole life, and I looked at him, and I said, there's something legitimate here, I just feel, but I don't understand it, it's very fuzzy, and I just don't get it exactly. But I try to read, I try to read what he said and look at his pictures and stuff. And I just say, I wonder if this is it. I wonder if he really knows the truth. I wonder if he really knows the truth. It's maybe. So I went through phases with Ramana. I'd get really into him, and then kind of like, I'm not sure. And then later on, years later, I'd get really into him again, and then I kind of, wow. But he's so, he says, you know, he just doesn't, says just sit here and don't do anything. What? Because when you're young, you want to fix the world, right? And I said, he's not doing anything to fix the world. And so, is that right? You know? So I said, nah, I don't know. But. So, and then I get back to him again, and then finally showed up in a dream. And then I said, wow. And that was super impressive. That made a lasting impression upon me. I had a direct contact with him, and he didn't big time me or anything. He just said, "Oh, you're gonna be big time." I said, "You're headed towards it, so don't quit." I said, "What?" He says, "Yeah. Don't quit." This is what he told me. You know, you keep working. You're doing great. Just keep on going the direction you're going in. That'll take you there. I was like, wow. And he was just the you know, just so indescribable in terms of his just simple kindness. Yeah, it's just, you can only experience it. Sincerity, absolute honest sincerity, kindness, and also certainty. You know, it's all there, and it's just wow. So, what? And then now I've gotten back to Ramana. Periods of very intense focus on him. He's on my screensaver, so I'm staying very much in touch with him and focusing a lot, along with other focus. But what's the point of all this? The point is, using this as an example, is what you have to do to not stall out is you just have to hang around the fragrance, just keep smelling the fragrance and say, where's this coming from? You know, there's something I really like on this. Is it this? I don't know, is it this? But there's some truth somewhere, I'm just not sure. And you just keep hanging out with it. This is pretty much all that anyone can do. Coming from where we're at, being maniacs, you just simply keep hanging in there. It's like those who go see like a band, like a really, really good garage band or something. And some kids just like that, just like love to just hang out. But they can't play, you know, hardly at all. They say, wow, but these guys are just great, unbelievable. They just hang out and hang on, hang out. And gradually, you know, they start getting some confidence. Maybe they start practicing the guitar, you know, and they say, I can never get in a band like that and play like that. You know, but maybe they start a little bit of band, they start playing a little bit, and gradually they get better and better and better and better and better. And they never lose touch with it. They're just something that attracts them. You know, they're compelled to just kind of hang out. So it's like anything that you feel you're not really very good at it at all. But so what you have to do is hang out with it, stay in contact with it. That's the whole key to your success and not stalling out, is you stay in contact with it. You may kind of drift back a ways, but then you drift towards it more. Then you drift away a little bit, then but you have to keep trying to discern, you know, where is this truth coming from? What is the truth? Where I know there, I just feel like there's truth somewhere, but I'm not sure what it is. You have to keep, that's like you sort of like I say, like a bloodhound. Their whole purpose is to find, you know, that smell. Where is it coming from? And they won't stop until they find it. It's sort of like built into their psyche that this is what they do. They track down that scent. So we have to be like that bloodhound. We have to track down the scent. Where is it coming from? Where is it coming from? I really want to find that. It's kind of like an adventure. I look at it, my life is like an adventure of tracking down the truth. Where is it coming from? And so it has been a super adventure. And I'm still tracking it down. Because the latest one is Jamyang Kensi Choki Lodro. Is that's keeping my adventure going. I say, hey, well, wait a minute. He said that someone came to me and the way he embraced me and treated me. I said, what is going on here? So it's got my attention. It gets my attention, very much so. Now, so we have some answers here. You might be thinking, what can I do? You stay in touch, you hang out, and accept the fact that that right now you're just hanging out and you're not quite sure, and you don't know whether what's being said is true or not, but there's some fragrance, you smell some fragrance. So you don't quit. You don't quit. You don't stall out. You refuse to stall out. So the answer is to how can you avoid stall out? You refuse to stall out. Say, not yet, not right now, maybe later, but I'm on this adventure. I feel like I still feel adventurous in terms of my discernment isn't quite complete. I want to somehow, find it. I want to find what I'm looking for, really. And ultimately, the paradox is what we're looking for. We find out that what we're looking for doesn't exist, never has, and therefore we don't need to keep looking for it. And then we awake to the nature of what is. What is it? Isness. As it isness. We awake to as it isness. Oh. Yeah, they say it's always been. Oh, as it isness, yeah. Wow. So the key is to just keep hanging out with it. You have to have the sense of you're tracking it down, of adventure. This is what you're really intrigued. There's something that it's a very deep intrigue that you have. You have to honor that. Have to honor it. The world doesn't honor it at all. The ego doesn't honor this at all. This is this collective stall out that we're talking about. Is it doesn't honor this feeling you have of this is my life's purpose. I really not ready to stall out yet and listen to the ego. Because I feel that there's a presence of truth somewhere. I'm not just sure where it is. Well, the answer is it's everywhere. So of course, when we're searching for it somewhere, we miss the everywhereness of it. Okay? So it's in this table. No, it's everywhere. It's not in this table and here. It's smoothly everywhere. But that's a slight digression to the pragmatic aspect of this video. So, for example, we're using this as an example. Jamyang Kensi Choki Lodro. My intrigue is who is this? And how great of a teacher is he really? What are his capacities? I'm intrigued. I want to find out. I don't really know for sure. Not many do at all, actually. Maybe almost nobody knows what he's really about. It's very intriguing to me because the tradition of Tibetan Buddhism is Samaya, there's a secrecy thing. But it's secrecy in a certain way where you don't talk about your capacities openly. In fact, you downplay them to an extreme extent. And he is just, I read what he's written, it's just so extraordinary. I can't believe how self-effacing he is and how he, he accused himself of just a stubborn parasite, this stubborn parasite, Choki Lodro, doesn't know what he's talking about, has no Dharma understanding whatsoever. And that's how he speaks of himself. So he doesn't give you even a clue about, what his capabilities are, hardly a clue. But then again, he'll start talking about the absolute viewpoint, the true viewpoint of no viewpoint, smoothly and easily, and as if this is what he abides as it isness. And so you say, what is this? This kind of throws us off the scent, doesn't it? Because and then the same writing, he'll talk about himself as a complete maniac. He has no clue about the Dharma. Doesn't know what he's talking about, and it's just a stubborn parasite. And so I have to dig through it. I'm trying to discern here. I find this very compelling because there's indications that he's vastly greater than people realize. But it's Tibetan way is such that they don't want you to focus on the miracles and the powers and the graces and stuff. They want you focused on the as it isness, okay, to make this power shift from searching for what isn't to realizing there's only as it isness everywhere. There's no gradations to it at all. The vision is there's no gradations. So if you're heavily into this graduated endeavor of trying to sort something out, you can't see the vision of oneness, the as it isness, smoothed out sameness. You would like, but what happened to my path? What happened to my success? I was trying to discern what's higher and what's lower, and this and this better and that. And I'm trying to purify the samsaras and my karma. I'm trying to purify. I completely lost sight of my work. What was I working on? I don't see it anymore. It's terrible. There's fear of that. There's nothing to work on. There's absolutely nothing to work on. Never has been. So I'm looking for this. And Jamyang Khyentse Choki Lodro, he calls himself the stubborn parasite Choki Lodro. Tukul Lodro, they called him. In the monastery training, Tukul Lodro. And he got severe beatings from his mentor, his teacher. It's amazing the harshness they had. And they said that when he cut his hair, shaved his head, you could see all the scars on his head from the beatings that he got. And he said, my teacher beat me whether I was good or bad. It made no difference. It made no difference, you see, what the teacher was getting at. This graduated endeavor, trying to be good. There's nothing to purify. There's no viewpoint like that at all. So we have this extremely interesting situation that there's this teacher, Tibetan mass teacher, who's made his, gave his calling card here in the West, made his presence known, at least to me, and I believe that someone else here is watching these videos has also said that he's made his presence known to him as well. And he's very much involved was in his life. You look at his life and what he did, etc., etc. It's this very interesting scenario here. Nobody really knows exactly what he's capable of. And he's so self-effacing. You start putting, you start getting these pieces. I'm putting all these pieces together, and it's kind of like something that intrigues us. Really, this is what I'm finding. It's like, let's find out what he's capable of. Isn't this very interesting? Actually, very compelling. What can he do for us? In terms of what? Preventing our stall out. Okay, do you hear this? Preventing our stall out. And how is our stall out prevented? By being attracted to this as it isness. So, what can he do to attract us to the as it isness and prevent our stall out? So you see where we're going with this. You see how I'm framing the situation and looking at it here. Now, we know about Jesus and Buddha and these various teachers, right? Okay. And we've gotten so used to it, we sort of lack this feeling of adventure and discovery, which we like. We really like it. We kind of go, yeah, I know, I already know, but I'm still stalling out, But here, we don't know hardly anything. Even the Tibetans don't really know. Some of them insist that he's one of the greatest masters of all time, maybe the most accomplished that we know of, the master of masters, just absolutely extraordinary. So some of the top Tibetan Buddhists, this is their viewpoint. So where did they get that viewpoint? They had contact with them. They stories are told that we don't hear about. But he was so subtle and self-effacing and drawing no attention to any of it that you wonder. Maybe he has more capability. His capabilities are so astonishing that if we knew about it, we'd get the jitters. And so he just presents himself as just, you know, a bungling idiot and doesn't really know any dharma. He doesn't, so everything he ever said, you know, he goes, nah, I'm just a, you know, I'm terrible. I don't know anything. Is that not someone that may be trying to tone down what he's about so that we don't get the jitters? It certainly sounds like it to me. I mean, that's certainly a possibility, right? It is a possibility. If you look at what he actually did, which they, by your fruits, thy fruits you shall know them, what he did was quite extraordinary, actually. And he is perhaps as responsible as anyone for the world not stalling out already, collectively stalling out. He is the work he did to empower Tibetan Buddhism and keep its spirits high and to help it disseminate throughout the world after the situation of the Red Chinese in Tibet. How he anticipated that all of that, and how he got everyone, you know, primed for some big push, and how he helps smooth out the whole sectarianism through ecumenicalism and the Rime movement. He was behind all of that. All of it. And what they say, what he accomplished is hard to believe. How much he did and how many empowerments. It's like they can't quite comprehend, you know, what happened. And yet he just seemed like, you know, just almost like a nobody, just a self-effacing nobody. So you start to put some of this together. And he doesn't really want us to know too much, because we might get the jitters. This is how a possible viewpoint. Now maybe he's just a nice, benevolent, compassionate lama, like so many Tibetan Buddhists, you know, prayers for the world, well-being for all the world, compassion, and smile a lot and talk about how important it is to generate bodhicitta. And maybe, you know, he's just kind of like that, just kind of run-of-the-mill thing. But then you get all this other evidence that doesn't quite fit with that at all. Again, some of the top Tibetan Buddhist mass gurus say he may be the most accomplished Tibetan Buddhist of all time that's ever been. They said we don't know for sure because we don't have the written kind of written records from others, but they say their opinion is that is possible. But so then you have to say, well, wait a minute, because we have some very accomplished Vajrayana Buddhists throughout history, you know, and they're putting him, you know, saying that for from their standpoint he you know he's you know, up in that absolute top echelon. But what does that mean? Well, we don't even know what that means, actually. Because the samaya is so strong, but you can kinda get some picture, but it's I've really worked at it, and I can't really say what it means. I can't really say what it means. They're very, very good at not overloading anybody and playing it cool, very cool. Some like poker players, very good poker players. We don't know what they can do. I think that's the best way to put it. We don't know. But there's something they can do. We don't know what their capacities are, but throughout history we get some sort of, I get this feeling, you know, that they absolutely are speaking from the standpoint. John Young is speaking, it seems to be coming from the absolute non-dual viewpoint that nothing has ever happened. And he's doing it effortlessly, you know, it's just effortless. I mean, he is absolutely established in that, as if it were, you know, a piece of cake for him. And he has all, and he's able to, has this vast viewpoint, totally vast viewpoint of, but he doesn't even need to talk about or say anything about it, because for him, it's just, this is just normal, completely normal for him. And so we have this wild card, actually, is what I'm trying to get at. Jamyang Khyentse Choki Lodo is this wild card that we don't know how it plays out. Do we have other lamas and Rinpoches, Tulkus, and saints, sages? Oh, yes, we do. Yes, we do. But for them, it seems a little more obvious how it plays out with them, I would say. They're helpful, etc. But we really don't know how Jamyang Khyentse Choki Lodro, that wild card, we it's very much an unknown. And yet it's starting to play out. So this is what we're getting at here. He's starting to play his cards. This is what's exciting. Very exciting. And during the daytime, I get these breakthroughs of just suddenly, wow. And I get the jitters kind of from it, because I suddenly realize that, you know, that I have these breakthroughs that where, again, that wow, jitter. And then I kind of go back into, like, you know, just, I don't know really, you know, what's going on. And then I'll see more clearly, say, oh my gosh, he's starting to play his cards. Who is this card shark? Who is this card player? Right? Who is he? Who is this card player? We don't know. Well, we do know something. We do know something. I'm digging, as I am very good at. As I've spent my whole life, you know, digging into the truth, you know. Come on, let's find it. So, I can tell you something. What I've found out so far. I don't want to get in trouble, but I don't think I will. I'm telling you the context here is that he's starting to play his cards. Who is this card player? Seriously, this got to take this very seriously, because we don't know who this card player is exactly. And I don't even think that most Tibetans know either exactly. I don't think very few know who is this card player actually. Well, when he was younger in the Shedra, the monastic teaching university, his tutor, they asked all the young monks there, they did a practice. He said, I want all of you to dream who you were in a past reincarnations and tell me who you were, if you get some impression. And then next, you know, after a couple of days or whatever, they went through this practice. And so he'd ask each one, what were you? And they'd say, well, I was this great lama, I was this unrealized master, and all this kind of thing, whatever. They all had this, some, you know, sort of, like, you know, really accomplished thing, a big deal. And then they asked Jamyang, okay, Tulku Lodro, what do you, he was the heir to this seat, because the reincarnation of Jamyang Khyentse Wangpo, he was recognized. So he was, the Tulku means that one who's going to assume the role of authority over this monastery or a seat, you know, of teaching. So, but they treated him just, you know, like anyone else there. It's very strong training. And, but, you know, they respected him. But they asked him, okay, what did you see? And he said, well, I just saw myself I very clearly as someone dressed in blue robes with white, sort of some sort of white clothing with a blue cloak over it, with my hair pulled up on a top knot, with turquoise earrings. And he said, from central Tibet. He said, from central Tibet, and that's who I was. I was absolutely clear about that's who I was. And he just shrugged his shoulders, and that's it. And everybody's laughing at him, and they were poking fun at him, and said, "Yo, here's a Tulku Lodro, and we, you know, he's reincarnation, but that's all he comes up with, just some country bumpkin or something. You know, wow, you know, we're much better than him, and we got these great incarnations before." But the tutor, who was very advanced lama, was astonished and amazed by it. He said, "Shh, shh, shh, no. He says, "Are you sure?" And he says, yes, very clear. He says, "Oh my God." And it was an extreme wow moment for this advanced lama. He was just shocked and stunned him. And then he realized who Jamyang Khyentse Choki Lodro was in a previous life, at least one of them, which was King Trisung Detsen. I think it's Trisung Detsen, or something like that, Trisung Detsen, which is the second Dharma King, Emperor of Tibet, who was the very one that invited Padmasambhava and Vimalamitra, and there's one other there, brought Tibetan Buddhism to Tibet in the first place. He's an extremely important person in the history of the world, actually, because he was responsible. He's really the one that galvanized Tibetan Buddhism, which is a very important historic force in this world for preventing a collective stall out. Are you getting what I'm getting goosebumps of what I'm talking about here? So the purpose of the Dharma is to prevent a collective stall out here among us, which really will set us back very badly. And Tibetan Buddhism has done a vast amount to protect us from a collective stall out. And King Trisung Detsen is the one who invited these great Buddhists to Tibet, including Padmasambhava, this avatar, to this massive translation project that's, well, how long it took, I don't know, long time, was it 30 years, 15, 30 years, it was a massive, massive effort. They translated all the Buddhist teachings into Tibetan, and then disseminated it and started putting monasteries in. You know, Padmasambhava established Samya Monastery, the first monastery in Tibet. He's the one that did this. So he is extremely important in the religious history of this planet, King Trisung Detsen. And Jamyang Khyentse Choki Lodro was Trisung Detsen. So hearing this, I just stopped in my tracks. Yeah, we know about the incarnational thing about the Tibetans. Everyone's some incarnation of someone. But when you get a great master that people recognize and showed in every possible way that he's fully enlightened, they know who they were in a previous life. They're not going to, you know, it's a sure thing. So it's not just some vague, well, me. No. You know, he knows who he was in a previous life for sure. So this should make all of us stop right in our tracks here. It made me stop. I'm still, you know, wowing this. Now, King Trisung Detsen's daughter, Pema Sol, she died. She's the one that died when she was like six or eight years old, real young. Padmasambhava brought her back to life. And then she didn't last too much longer, but then she reincarnated, and her, maybe one other, at some point, she reincarnated as Longchenpa. So a previous life of Longchenpa was Pemaso, the daughter of King Trisen Detson. Yeshi Sogal, which was the consort of Pamasawa, became the wife of Trisen Detson. I mean, he is like a central hub of the whole Tibetan Buddhist history. You might be saying, well, I'm glad that John Young hasn't come to be. Jitter. So yeah, you can imagine my position where he has. It's like, have to dissipate the jitters. But he was completely indifferent to it, you know. It's like he came from the standpoint of as it isness. Nothing's ever happened. Trisen Detson never happened. Tibetan Buddhism never happened. Nothing has ever happened. Existence has never happened. He's coming from that as it isness, the no viewpoint viewpoint. So there's nothing, there's no big ado about anything, you know, from that standpoint, right? So he's not trying to make a big, nothing, he just said, well, that's who I was, and then no fixation upon it at all, no fixation, he doesn't fixate upon anything, accomplishment or anything like that, he doesn't see any accomplishment, everything is self-accomplished already in the as it isness. But King Trisen Detson is again one of the most important people in history. There's no doubt about it. But if you list some of the most important incarnation people, let's just call them people, but in history, he's one of them. Because he sparked this amazing fire of Dharma in the world. He said, let's get it done. Let's do this. Let's do this. And he galvanized it. And he funded it. And he did everything to make it happen. And he's extraordinary historical personage. Absolutely extraordinary. And he was received the transmission from Padmasambhava. And I mean, he's so connected to the heart of it all. So connected to the heart of it all. And so we're talking about that's a lot to talk about. It's a lot to consider, isn't it? And so here he shows up in the 20th century and galvanizes a massive effort to preserve Tibetan Buddhism. He's the one really behind it. Not save Tibetan Buddhism because it exists, but to save it to prevent all the rest of us from believing that anything exists. To stalling out in belief in time. time, space, process, and form. So really, in the last 50 years, the Tibetan Buddhists have done a massive amount of helpfulness for the world to prevent the collective stall out from taking place. And it's the teachers and those that he galvanized and taught that have been responsible for this. You see how important he is? He actually takes action that works. Trisen Detsen actually did establish Tibetan Buddhism in Tibet. He actually did it. Here's someone that actually did what has turned out to be extremely vitally important for the world to prevent a collective stall out. So he has the capacity to draw us in to this collective effort. See, he has that ability. He's done it. He's already done it as Trisen Detsen, as Chamyon Kenti Choki Lodro. He's already done it at least twice. We don't know. He may have done it other times as well. So, we just wow it, that's all. Wow, this is really cool, isn't it? Wow. Keep in mind, the only thing between us and a collective stall out is the presence of truth in the world. And not losing touch with it. That's it. But I'll take that away and we will stall, collectively stall out. So those who are really intent on collectively stalling out, meaning, again, the ego says, well, we love reality, right? Yeah. Okay, so if we make misery true, then we'll love misery, and so no problem. Those who believe in this logic have this collectivist belief in pulling everyone down into misery. And you might say that was typified by the Red Chinese. And what did they do? They tried to destroy the Dharma because they felt that was getting in the way of their happiness. Because the Dharma said, no, you can't make illusions true. It's impossible. Nothing's ever happened. You can't purify anything. There's nothing to purify. Nothing's ever happened. They said, no, we got. So they tried to destroy the Dharma in Tibet. They really did. People say, well, you know, you trampled on human rights. You did all this terrible stuff. But you didn't, you know, a lot of the monks escaped. But what they were really after was destroying the monasteries and the icons and the treasures and the culture, which they did do. They certainly did do that. They did a very thorough job of it. However, Chamyon Kenshi Choki Lodro foresaw all of this and put a massive effort prior to this happening to galvanize the spirit of the Tibetans, of the Dharma there, so that it had the courage to go out into the world, okay, and help spread this confidence in truth around the world. He's the one most responsible for this. Hey, if you met him, you think he's your uncle or something, you know, just no indication of anything. Poker face. But he's got a joker up his sleeve. We don't know what it is. So I don't know. What are the chess moves he has up his sleeve? I don't know. At this point, you think he knows Padmasambhava? You bet he does. You think he knows Longchenpa? You bet he does. In his biography of his visions and empowerments, which only covers 2/5 of his life, he says he had 17 visions, experiences, communications, visions of Longchenpa. 17. We think that, you know, Jigme Lingpa had like 3 powerful transmissions, Dharmakaya, Samakaya, and Ramanakaya, body, mind, speech, transmissions, that we think that's like extraordinary, but Choki Lodro, Tukul Lodro, 17, and that's just Longchenpa. He had communication with all the Tibetans throughout history, the great Tibetans in his life. It seems like it was just constant communication with all of them. But for him, he didn't talk about it at all, just, you know, because that's just for him. It's just, you know, this is my business. This is what I do. No reason to talk about it. You know, nothing to brag about or anything. No. But so 17 communications with Longchenpa, visions, empowerment, 17, and that's just a drop in the bucket, of the totality of what he experienced. Just a drop in the bucket. So you say, well, wait a minute here. Wait. This isn't well known. This isn't well known, of course. We've been badly distracted from the Dharma, from the gospel, haven't we? Now, so I'm digging into this more. So I take this nap this afternoon because I'm really tired, because I did this vast workout yesterday with the legs. It's pretty amazing what I did. And then today I lifted a bunch of weights and really did the upper body, a bunch of stuff. The upper body's like, wow. I just felt so tired. I just got to sleep. But I was napping, and I was asking him to help us out. So I said, could you give us some advice? And I'll write it down. I'll do something. Can you just, you know, could you start communicating with us, please? If you can, if that's one of your capabilities. You know, whatever your capabilities are is my prayer today. Let us start experiencing them. I don't know what your capabilities are. I really don't. I don't know. I still don't know. It's sort of an unknown. Tibetans, again, they play their cards close to the vest. They only let you know if they need to. It's need to know kind of thing. But if Longchenpa needed to be somewhere quickly, guess what? He was just there. That kind of thing. He didn't say anything about it or nothing. But, I mean, it's almost like whatever they need to do, they can do it. But they don't make any big deal about it at all. Don't even talk about it. They don't say anything to the local people because they'll get all jittery, you know. There's this thing about, you know, don't spread these miracles around so much, because it makes people jittery and they start coming to you. Please, can you help me with my, you know, horse and this and that, you know. So they say, no, I'm just a little old man that is a stupid, you know, stubborn parasite. I don't know any Dharma at all. That they really play it down. But again, if Longchenpa, whatever he needed to do, it was done. If he needed to just to locate himself somewhere, he was done. So we don't know, you know, what they can do or what we don't. We're in the dark, kind of. So I'm praying for this, and then I'm taking a nap, and then I'm starting to have all these formulations of wisdom in my mind, that just little snippets that come in, this and this and this, and I kind of wake up and say, oh, that was really wise, and then another snippet. I'm starting to have all these snippets of little advice and stuff in my mind, and I'm doing the mantra, Jamyang Kyentse Choki Lodro, Jamyang Kyentse Choki Lodro, Jamyang Kyentse. It's either for us for say Jamyang Kyentse, say Jamyang Kyentse. I gotta get used to that. Jamyang Kyentse Choki Lodro, Jamyang Kyentse Choki Lodro. And I'm saying, come on, help us out. And it's like, I feel like I'm getting some transmissions from him, from his mind, about this wisdom transmissions. Now, I don't remember, I couldn't quite remember what they were, because I was just testing it out. But that is the experience that I had. Now, also today, I asked him, why me? What's going on? I don't understand. I don't know what can I do? I don't know. I'm willing to do what I can do, but I don't know what I can do. I'm an idiot. You know, I'm a maniac. And the answer I got, very powerful immediately, was this, we really need you. You know, we really need you. I said, what? But that's what I got. And it's very profound. The response I got is like, we really, not just want, we need you, you know. And it's like, what? Kind of stopped me in my tracks. I said, you need me. I'm an idiot. But at least I know I'm an idiot. I'm a maniac. At least I know I'm a maniac. You see, that's something. Right? And I know I'm searching for what's not here. I'm still looking for what's not here, you know. I'm an idiot. But at least I know I kind of... It's, you know, I'm kind of waking up to this. In some way. But he seems to be like, you know, recruiting me, like, hey, I really need you, you know. Well, you know, he's a great recruiter. That's how you build a big, great company, huh, or something. You recruit the right people. So he's probably out, you know, recruiting people right now. And me being such an idiot, I keep thinking, oh, well, he doesn't really want me, you know. There's this little, you know, game going on in your mind that happens, you know, but you just have continuity fear, and wow is all. You just wow it. And so, okay, that's just a play of continuity fear. You know, we'll see how it is when the wow calms down. Don't struggle with it. Just notice it and say, okay, that's my idiocy, perfunctory idiocy, just jumping up, doing a little puppet dance in front of me. You know, don't worry about it. Just keep working. What could I do? You know, what the heck could I do to help him out? I don't know. But he must know. You presume it. If he's recruiting, he must know. He's got an idea. He's like the founder of a company, King Tyson Denson. He's saying, hey, I'm inviting, you know, I'm putting together, you know, I want some effort here to preserve the Dharma, the gospel. What do I have to offer? Well, yeah, very ecumenical, I would say. So I have sort of a fresh viewpoint that's not stuffed into any tradition at all. So he's apparently sees some usage for me. I can't quite imagine what it could be, really. I'm trying to say, what can I do? I don't know. But I'm intrigued. King Tyson Denson calls you. You answer the call. The king calls you, you answer the call because he says, hey, I need you right now. But being the idiot that I am, I kind of like, you know, dragging my feet or something. But this is standard for, you know, the continuity fear is what that causes you to drag your feet. You know, you think you'd be, oh yeah, sure, okay, but then you kind of like, oh, doubts creep in, and then you're like, well, I don't know, what do I got to do? I don't know. Start making excuses and doubts and all this thing, but that's just standard. You know, it's just par for the course. So you know, you make par and hole. Okay, it's fine. It's no big deal. Just go to the next hole, you know. It's like that. So you make these breakthroughs, and then you get some jitters, and you say, oh, okay, it's fine. Jitters, all right, that's sure to arise. That's fine. Welcome, jitters. Happy you're here. And you act out a little bit of resistance and snarliness and stuff like, you know, trying to find something bad about it, you know, try to justify your pushing it away. No, I don't want that. You push it away. Push the ice cream away. No, it's looks terrible. You're trying to convince yourself not to eat the ice cream. I'm getting stronger. There's no question about it. And working out, it's working gradually, very slowly, but it is working. And this is kind of a good experience for me. Like if you take a year, focus on the Dharma for a year, your spiritual workout, you know, by the end of that year, you will be significantly stronger in your faith, significantly stronger, noticeably in all regards, 360 degree. And the stuff that used to cripple you won't cripple you anymore. So some of the stuff that I used to have trouble with now, you know, I can lift stuff with one hand now that I could hardly lift with two before. It's just a state, you know, it's just... It doesn't faze me like it used to. It didn't get me down like it used to. I'm stronger now. I had to go up some hills today, small hills, and so I just ran up them. I said it's easier for me to just run up the hill than to walk. Actually, I didn't notice any difference between running and walking up these steep hills. Just ran. That's a piece of cake for me. Nothing. Didn't even feel hardly anything. Hardly winded at all. Before it's like, oh, I got to go up that hill. It was like, oh my gosh, like wow. This is really, really getting me down. So all the stuff get me down like this. So I'm, but now it doesn't, you know, touch me. It doesn't even faze me. So that's, if you put a year of effort in, really dedicated, you're going to find that what used to really get you down doesn't faze you anymore. So how good is how, you know, what kind is a good, isn't that good fruit? Isn't it great fruit? Yeah, it's super fruit, isn't it? How are we doing here? We're cruising right along. Where are we at? I don't even know where we're at, to tell you the truth. What? I thought it was 42 minutes. No, it's an hour and 42. That's not possible. Is that possible? No. That's not accurate. Is that accurate? I don't think so. Something's weird here. It's almost 11. That means I started at 9. Well, that's amazing. Yeah, because it was dusk and it was still light when I started, which means it was like around 9 o'clock, and it's now 10:50. So that would have been an hour and 50 minutes, and this is what it's kind of showing. So it was close, maybe just after 9 o'clock. Wow, that's unbelievable. I lost track of time completely. Actually, I what the heck have I been saying for an hour and 43 minutes here? How is this possible? I don't know what's going on here. Huh. Wow. This is amazing. I don't know what to say. I still have no recollection of spending all this time, like the hour 40 minutes. Wow. Just wow it. I've been able to sleep better now than before, so I'm hanging in there now. I was having just incredible sleep deprivation. It's just abominable, terrible stuff. I got this new pillow, the Sobeikawa pillow, something like that. It's a buckwheat husk pillow. It's kind of small. I just think it's the best pillow there is, and it's just made an enormous difference. Actually, there's no struggle with the pillow anymore. No fighting the pillow all night. It's just awesome. It's just awesome. It only costs like $24 or something. It's unbelievable. You can order it online. The original buckwheat husk pillow, some Sobeikawa something like that, Japanese pillow. And it's the authentic one is only like $25. It really is the authentic one. And you just shape it any way you want, and it just stays in that shape beautifully. And if you move your head a little bit, it just shifts the butt. It's just, I mean, it's so much better than all these modern Tempur-Pedic stuff, you know, this faux memory foam, which is all, gets too hot, it's too heavy, you sink in. It's terrible. This buckwheat is way better. It is way better. But it's also small, so you can put your arm around the side of it instead of having to put your arm up on the pillow or something, or fight moving the pillow around. It's kind of small. And so you can put your arm to the side or shoulder to the side, and it's just your head's on it. This is beautiful, man. It's made a big, huge difference for me. I've been getting more sleep, better quality sleep, which is really important. I was able to drive all the last 2 days, all day long, work long hours, 9.5 hour days straight, and I didn't get fatigued driving or anything. I didn't feel this drowsiness. It didn't hit me. Thank God for that. Been working out intensely, so doing everything, you know, keeping that good habits going. Now, it came to my attention that today was the All-Star game. Well, I don't think in my whole life I've ever missed the All-Star game for baseball. This is something like it's like so important to me. I never miss it. Basically, never missed it. I got to see the All-Star game. This is like a highlight of my year. One of the highlights is the All-Star game. Seeing all the All-Stars. I just get enthused about it. Well, today was the All-Star game, and I completely passed on it, you know, completely, because this is way more important. So you ask what kind of sacrifice you make. Well, you may not pay attention to something that used to be like really important to you, which I just did today. And I heard the Giants pitcher was starting, you know, this was like, you know, big people really kind of like, wow, yeah, this is gonna be really cool. It never occurred to me to turn it on. It never occurred to me. I said, what, are you kidding me? We're going to talk about John Mayankensi Chocolodro and who he really is and what could he be really doing here. He's here. He's doing something. Okay. This, I can tell you, he and Longchenpa and the Dharma Kings, they're doing something. There's something is up. Again, when I asked for help for the world, for the Dharma, I said, we're about ready to collectively stall out. That was November 2nd, 2014, I believe. Or is it 2013? It's been 2.5 years. So, more than 2.5 years. So, 2014, 2015, November, then a half year. It's 2013. Must have been 2013. November 2nd, 2013, I guess. Yeah, because now, so it's been more than, it's a little more than 2.5 years, because we have July, August, September, October. Yeah, 2 years, 8 months. When I made that plea, I said, I my feeling is this world, we're all going to, it's going to be a collective stall out, and that this is just drastically terrible, and this must not happen. And I just fiercely said, no, it will not happen. And who is with me? Who will stand with me? I will stand. I said, I will stand and preserve the Dharma. Who is with me? And that very night again, that night after I pleaded, Longchenpa showed up in my dream, introduced himself. I'm here. Says, I'm here, and I'm going to I'm going to stand with you. You know, I'm here to protect the Dharma. There's no question about it. He was absolutely firm about it. No oscillation in his mind. He says, I'm all in. I am all in on this. So, there is some will to protect the Dharma and prevent a collective stall out that is present here. There's something going on. Longchenpa has got something up his sleeve. King Trisen Detsen, Chamyang Kyentse Chogyi Lodro, Padmasambhava, the whole Tibetan tradition, Tibetan Buddhism, has got something up their sleeve. They plan to do something. Jesus has something up his sleeve. He plans to do something. So, we don't know exactly. They play their cards close to the vest. Need to know basis, which is fine. It doesn't overburden us that way, you know. I can't really attract all this attention by saying, yeah, I know what's going to happen. Oh, everybody, you know, exactly this. And people say, oh, really? And they think I can do something for them or something. But again, all you can really do for the world is to diffuse the scent of truth. And so they feel that they don't quite want to stall out yet. That's pretty much what most people, where they're at. Some are more advanced than that. But it's enough to say, nah, don't really want to stall out, actually. Not yet. And that's enough to thwart the plans of those who want this vast collective stall out. So we're all in misery and believing that. Well, then, misery must be true, and this is, we love truth. We love misery, and we're in love. Everything's fine. It's enough to prevent that madness. Extreme madness. Now, we're getting one more issue here, which is there going to be some stall out? You know, yeah, it certainly seems that way, doesn't it? But there are degrees of stall out. You could say this. You don't want an all-out stall out. An all-out stall out. Yeah, you don't want an all-out stall out. You don't want a Stalag 13 all-out stall out. And so if you could take the edge off of it, it's just like you take a sharp knife and turn it into a butter knife. You know, you get maniacs wielding butter knives. It's, you know, it's kind of like more farcical than severe, isn't it? You see all these, I got a butter knife. I'm fencing with you, and I'm going to get you. And I got my butter knife out too. And you know, they go through the motions of being maniacs, but in the end, you know, they're kind of like, they get tired. And, how are you? Well, I'm okay. I'm fine. How are you? Yeah, I'm good too. The butter knife didn't get you. No. It just kind of bruised me a little bit. You know, scratched me and stuff. But I'm okay. You're okay? Yeah, I'm okay. Oh, great. That was kind of stupid. What the heck were we doing anyway? I don't know. Okay, can't even remember. Let's move on from this. So if you take if you blunt the edge of the knife, the stall out's not so bad. It makes a big difference, a really big difference. Someone told me a story about this turkey. Someone went turkey hunting and they wouldn't let them shoot the turkey, so he tried to kill the turkey with his bare hands. And the turkey just mauled it, scratched and bloodied the heck out of him. It was terrible. What an idiot, you know. What a maniac. I've been around turkeys a lot, whole flocks of turkeys and stuff, walking very closely to them. And they've never given the slightest threatening, you know, quality to me at all. Because I, hello turkeys, how are you, you know, and I just, because I'm not trying to kill them. Apparently turkeys can be ferocious if you try to attack them, if you corner them. Their claws, they're ferocious, their beaks and claws. And, but I'm not trying to corner and trap and kill a turkey, so, you know, they're not attacking me. Okay. Okay. So if we leave the turkeys alone, okay, they'll leave us alone. I never felt threatened by any turkeys at all. They never made any threatening gestures to me or anything. And they just kind of walk by me and look like and say, okay, this guy's cool. He's very relaxed and calm. He's not, they just feel they're very, animals are very keen about, are you threatening them or are you just in a peaceful state of mind? And if you're peaceful state of mind, they say, okay, there's no threat. People say, oh, stay away from turkeys, they're really dangerous. I said, oh, well, I mean, I've never experienced that. I don't feel that. I've never felt that at all. Yeah, anything could be pretty threatening if you try to kill it, corner and kill it, right? They're gonna fight back. So if we just don't try to be total maniacs, you know, we're not gonna get mauled so bad, right? So if we just say, I don't really feel like being a total maniac right now because I smell this barbecue. It's like I'm kind of hungry and I'm starving actually. And I'm smelling the scent of food somewhere. And of course the world said, no. If we all starve together, we won't starve. You know, it'd be great. And they said, well, yeah, but you know, maybe, but I smell the scent of food somewhere. I just feel there's food somewhere. So maybe we like don't have to starve, you know? So I'm kind of into that right now, actually. If we just do that, we got butter knives instead of, you know, sharp butcher's knives, you know? It so greatly lessen the mauling, you know, we won't be mauled. We'll kind of come out of the you know, be in the full maniac mode, and we'll say, wow, you know, I still smell that food, but I smell it even better now. I mean, I think I'm gonna try and find where that food's coming from. Ah, then you really start moving towards it. So this is the benefit of having the scent of as it isness in the world. It's supremely important. Even a little bit is enough to get the scent like, oh, there's some as it isness in the world. Wow. I don't really understand it, but I feel something. There's something, you know, something about Ram Maharshi, for instance. There's something about us. It's just wow, you know. It's like the scent of something that's sublime. There's something sublime there that I really want. I really he's kind of like gives off the scent that I really want. You know, this whatever it is. Well, that's enough to pull us out of full maniac mode. Got someone go crazy with a butcher knife, it's bad news. You got someone go crazy with a butter knife, it's not as not such bad news. Right? Yeah. Now I had a very interesting experience. I worked out and in a very, very tough way with the legs, and I thought I'd be wiped out yesterday or today. I did it yesterday, today, but my legs feel like Superman today. It's like I feel like supercharged. I was like running everywhere and hopping and skating. It's like, wow, my legs feel powerful. I thought I'd just feel devastated. Maybe I'll feel devastated tomorrow, but there's something about when you really practice it. I don't know what it does. I still don't understand how the body works. It's kind of weird. But you might be surprised that you might feel really empowered if you really make a great effort at working out spiritually. You might end up feeling just like, wow, I can really, I don't really have to stall out right now. Maybe later I'll stall out, but I don't really feel like it right now at all. So I want you to consider this. Is this technique we have here? We have a number of techniques, and it's just like you say. You know, I don't. I maybe later I'll really want to stall out severely. That's okay. Maybe a little later I'll be a total maniac. Okay, yeah, I might want to do that, but not right now because I'm kind of into this spiritual fitness program, you know, and I'm kind of getting results, and I feel like maybe, you know, I could actually kind of get in shape, maybe, right? It's possible. I'm thinking myself, I think maybe I'm getting in shape. kind of is possible, you know? I'm getting this feeling. Maybe I'm getting in shape. Because when I was running, it was just like nothing. Bum, 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 bum. It's like, wow. It's like I get my kid again. You know, when you're a kid, you can run and just like, ah, yeah. Okay. It's like, it's almost like you forget right about, you know, you forget that what you did, because then you're ready to run again. When you get tired, you kind of stop, and then a little while later, you're ready to go again. And it doesn't really, it didn't really faze you so much, did it? When you were a kid, you kind of just liked running. So today I'd run to my vehicle. I ran across parking lots. Nobody runs through parking lots. I was running through parking lots because I was in a hurry. It's a good excuse. I forgot something. I go run back out, you know, go get it. And boy, you know, just scurrying across that fast, 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 grabbing stuff, each one arm, and just like carrying the stuff. It's really heavy. It's like, it's no problem. Whereas before, I'd be like discouraged, it'd be so hard, and I'd be so discouraged. Oh, the world's getting me down. Now it's just like, yeah, give me this. That's no problem at all. It's like, wow. This is kind of cool. I'm not so discouraged anymore. So when you really make an effort to be spiritual, get in spiritual shape, be a spiritual athlete, you at some point, you won't feel so discouraged anymore. This is the fruit. You just won't feel so discouraged. It's a gradual, general thing that just kind of creeps up, and just gradually you feel, you know, like not so discouraged, which is great, because then you don't stall out so severely, right? And then you keep trying to track down that scent, which isn't easy. All right, let's be honest here. So you don't get down if you're not enlightened. What's important is you're not stalling out so severely, and you're hanging out with it, and you're evaporating your continuity fear, which is all you can really do, because that's the only problem we have. Really, there aren't any other problems actually at all. Never has been. But the continuity fear is maybe it's the only problem we can really say is a temporary problem. It's like we're kind of afraid to stop looking for what isn't here now and see what's here now. That's the only problem we have. It's not like we're stuck in what's not here. How can we be stuck in what's not here now? It's not here now to be stuck in, right? I mean, not here nowness, how could anyone be stuck in it? It's not here now to be stuck in, is it? But the continuity fear we can be stuck in, because we say, I'm afraid of dropping this silly delusion, you know? So we are sort of stuck in the continuity fear, but it's evaporatable, okay? We can evaporate this continuity fear gradually. We get over the jitters. But again, how can we be stuck in what's not here now? Very wowish question, isn't it? Just hold this wowish question there. Just hold it. How can we be stuck in what's not here now? It's not here to be stuck in. Yeah, but I'm looking for it, you know. Well, I'm stuck in looking for it. But since it's not here now, I'm not really stuck in it at all, right? There's just a looking for it. And a continuity fear to stop looking for it. But we're not actually stuck in anything at all. We're not stuck at anything, right? Because we could just drop the looking for it and we'd realize we've never been stuck at all. So the looking for it isn't actually being stuck in it. You know, we're looking for, you know, where is that to be stuck in? It's not here right now, but where is it? I can't find it. How can we be stuck in what's not here right now? How can we be stuck in what's not here right now? Wow, the amount of disk space has gone down a lot, even though maybe I have to restart the computer, yeah. There's always some little thing with the computer, isn't there? I'm running out of disk space severely. But 4 and 3 is 7, so add 7 to 14, and I've got 21, so that's normal. I'm down to really, but I'm down just a little bit, but I'm just hanging in there, you know. I can't seem to free up any more disk space. I've tried everything. It's weird. But again, how can we be stuck? Okay, so this is a wow question. It's a wow question. It's a wow question. Just here, hang out with it. Just hang out with it. And just say, huh, there's something about that. You know, it's like, yeah, but I can't quite put it into context. Well, that's continuity fear. Is you're dancing, it's, you know, you're dancing to the tune of continuity fear. So you can't, you're still looking for what's not here and say, okay, but I don't really see it because it's not, it's, I can't find the not here-ness of that, you know. Okay, so how can we be stuck in what's not here? Oh yeah, but I'm not able to see the not here-ness of it. I can see it here, but I can't see the not here-ness of that, so I'm confused. You know? It's our habit to keep looking for what's not here now. Oh yeah, now that's great, but what about what's not here right now? You know, what's that like? Well, how can you experience what's not here right now to experience? It's wow, right? So like, wow. So we try to go into fantasy. So, well, I'm doing it right now. I'm fantasizing. No, because the fantasy's right here now. I'm thinking of 10 years ago. Where is that thought arising? Is it not arising right now? I'm fantasizing about someone who's not here right now. Well, isn't that fantasy right here right now? So what are we experiencing that's not right here right now? So just hear this, say, okay, I've heard this before, right? Okay. But just hang out with it. This prevents your stall out, a severe stall out. It's turning your sharp knife into a butter knife. It's tempering the metal, it's heating the metal up so it loses the sharpness of, the stall out loses its intensity, and you say, that stall out seems really interesting, but I got something else that's even more interesting right now. But maybe when I clear this up, I'll go back to stall out, but first I want to clear this up. This is all you have to do. You know, first I want to clear this up, and then maybe I'll get back to the stall out. You just stall out on the stall out. Stall out on the stall out. I don't know, what did I eat today? Stall out on the stall out. I know what I did. I got 3 papayas that were overly ripe, and I made a smoothie out of them with vanilla flavored protein drink. Bolthouse vanilla flavored protein drink, and that's it. Just those two things blended together, tasted pretty darn good. Except there's something, the papain or whatever it is, papaya. It gelified the whole thing. It all turned into gel. I couldn't drink it. When it was not gel, I could drink it. It was very great. But now it's like, I don't know, what do I do? Put some tart red cherry juice in there is what I'll do tomorrow. And blend it up and drink that down. Pretty cool drink, huh? Soy and whey protein drink with 3 papayas. I'll throw some tart red cherry juice in there. That's not bad. That's my food right now. I said, you know, I just said, let me eat some. What am I going to eat tonight? That was what I had this evening. Like, what? Who does that? I don't know. It's just, I tried it. I said, why not? It was really good. I couldn't find the chocolate drink. That with papaya, that's really good too. But the vanilla is really good too. It's like, wow. What a taste this has. Wow. Super. I can even throw some chocolate protein powder in there and get the chocolatey taste with vanilla too. Chocolate vanilla taste with papaya. blends up, purees up very nicely. But a little gel on you. Just keep in mind, strawberries gel too. A lot of fruits actually end up gelling. They got something pectin or something in them. It starts a chemical reaction. I got a ton of strawberries. I gotta keep making smoothies out of these strawberries. I got so many. It's like berry season right now. It's crazy. Cherries, strawberries, berries of every kind. I can't keep up. I'll just take like 20 strawberries and just, you know, make a smoothie and just chug it down. Yeah. Why not? Tart red cherry juice and strawberries. I don't know. Whatever. Whatever. Just whatever works. Just try different stuff and it's all good. Strawberry protein drink with strawberries is very good. Yeah, it's really great. Hit the weights today. Just, you know, stall out on the stall out as we're just sort of stalling out on the stall out here, right? Stall out on the stall out. And somebody told me a while ago, I was having trouble with my shoulders. We get older, we get partial tears in our shoulders and stuff, and you know, become very weak with your shoulders. Upper body becomes very weak. And it's like freaks you out. It creeps up on you. You don't realize it. Suddenly you're like, oh my God, oh, I'm old. I can't do any of the stuff I used to do with my upper body. So just like, I can't do any of this stuff. What happened? It creeps up on you badly. So it really got me very severely. And he said he was going through the same thing, same age, same problem. A lot of people, as they get to about 60, have the same problem. And his physical therapist, who's really a bigwig in physical therapy, he does professional sports teams, physical therapy, so he really knows what he's doing. He told him, he says, do push-ups, but do women's push-ups, he said. Because as you get older, the men's push-ups, where you're on your toes, your full body's on your toes, they become too difficult. And I tried to do them. I can't do men's push-ups anymore. I said, what? So he says, I've been doing women's push-ups. It's very helpful. I said, well, are you kidding me? I'm not doing women's push-ups. Come on. And so I refused to do them. I tried a couple times. Ah, it's ridiculous. I've never done that before. I do men's push-ups. But I can't do them. I said, what the heck is going on here? This is really bizarre. So, but how to do push-ups like that? It's very difficult, actually, but I found a way to do it. I have these barbells, and I put the barbells on the ground and grasp the bar between the barbells. They're like dumbbells, actually. And then I have this foam knee pad that cushions my knees, and I get my knees on the foam pad, and these barbells, and they go down, and I can go between them, kind of go lower, and then push back up, because the bar on the dumbbells is about, you know, it's about 4 inches off the ground, 3 or 4 inches off the ground. And it's like perfect. It's like perfect. So I did like 10 of them. And it was just crushing my upper body. Oh, man. It's brutal. I said, holy cow. Yeah, women's push-ups, guys. As you get, do it. I resisted it, but I'm into it now. I can see how tremendously helpful that is. I was dipping below the bar, actually. Like, we used to do dips. Remember, you go down, dip below. I don't think I could do a dip now to save my life. But this, at least, is sort of dipping down and enables you to then push back up. So you don't have to go onto the ground with your hands, flat hands on the ground. It's too difficult. Grip the barbells and do it that way. It works great. It works really great. What a great discovery, actually. It's fabulous. And then I got some weights from my uncle. My uncle, who's, you know, about as close to a saint as you're going to find here in the world. He had these barbells that he worked out with, you know, as it got older, until he was, you know, in his late 80s, when he finally passed away, unfortunately, in very unfortunate circumstances. I wish he was still here, you know. He gives you the flavor of the Dharma Kings in terms of his kind gentleness, but also his incredible memory and wisdom and everything. Anyway, I got his barbells from him. I've kept them all these years, and I was using them today, and they're just the right weight for this type of practice, you know, like this. And I invented some practices today, like by squats and then moving my arms one way, moving like this way, just throw myself off balance, and you practice keeping your balance. If really difficult exercises, it's like, so I'm kind of getting pretty good at various exercises, and passing them on to you. It wouldn't be a bad idea to kind of get in shape, you know, at this point, and so you don't get shamed or shocked into jumping into a, what do I call it? I'm not really focused on that so much now, but the yoga girl thing, mania, which is a distraction actually from hanging out with the non-dual truth. So I try to make sure that I'm feel like I'm in pretty good shape right now in various ways with my diet and everything, so I don't get pulled into any mania, you know, whatever. There's bound to be manias coming, many. If one doesn't get you, another one will. This is the problem, right? It's like dodgeball. All these dodgeballs being thrown at you, and it's like, can you dodge them all, right? That's the question, isn't it? So, stall out on the stall out. Stall out on the stall out. Can you be stuck in what isn't not right here right now? Can you be stuck in what's not here right now? Can you be actually stuck? Is that possible, actually? I mean, where's the quicksand to be stuck in? It's just a whim, but it's not here right now. Well, how can I be stuck? How can I be stuck at what's not here right now? I mean, if you're in quicksand, isn't the quicksand right here right now? If you are stuck in quicksand, couldn't you say, well, I'm stuck in what's here right now? But if there's no quicksand right here, I mean, am I stuck at all? I mean, what? How can I be stuck in what's not here right now? How can anybody be stuck in what's not here right now? How can anyone stuck in what they're not experiencing? How can we be stuck in not experiencing? Is that really stuckness? Or is it just a ridiculous convention that we're following? Of presuming that we're stuck. Is anyone really stuck at all, is the question? Is anyone really stuck at all? Even the slightest bit, actually. In terms of not here nowness? Is anyone stuck in not here nowness? Even though someone in quicksand, are they stuck in not here nowness? So is anyone really stuck at all? Because what is here now is freedom, actually, that we're not aware of because we keep thinking we're stuck and not here nowness. And where's the freedom there? We can't see the freedom either. We can't, because we can't even find the stuckness, you know, so we're not sure what to be free about. How to exercise our freedom. Yeah, I want to exercise my freedom, but this I'm stuck in what's not here right now, but I'm not really sure, you know, I can't really tell you what it really is, so I'm not really sure how to be free about it, you know. It's like that. Stall out on the stall out. Stall out on the stall out here. Just say, nah, not so fast. I think I'm going to stall out just a little bit on the stall out. Jam Yang has it's a role for me. I say, well, I'm worried, like, well, I probably won't be any good at it, or, you know, I won't like it, I'm not good at it. What am I good at? I don't know. I don't really think I'm good at anything. I'm just kind of, you know, dilettante-ish stuff, but I don't feel like I'm accomplished at anything, actually. So I don't know, you know, what I could do. Maybe carry his bags or something, you know, carry his suitcase, his luggage, pick him up at the airport. I'm just using metaphorically, I don't know. I mean, get his water, get his tea, you know, maybe I could just be a gopher or something, or I don't have any feeling of accomplishment in any way. So I don't know really what job I could possibly do except just hang out, and maybe I could just hang out, you know, play some golf and hang out and be around the situation, and maybe I could, I don't know what I could do, maybe sing in a band or something. Maybe. I was trying to sing today, I was having trouble trying to stay with Carl Wilson. I had trouble today. It comes and goes. It's pretty weird. I just have to keep working at it. There's a way to shape your mouth and where you're vocalizing in the mouth. At the front of the roof of the mouth, pushing it strongly, you get a higher sound. It can sound like Mike Love, the Beach Boys, if I kind of sing a frontal way. And but you know, there's techniques to it, but it feels kind of strained, and then I can't shift higher. It's a little, so I'm really kind of ragged right now. Really, I mean, you could hear the potential, but it's ragged still. Really, very ragged. But I was singing some songs. I sang it pretty well, but it was still some areas I was ragged in. I found the voice. There's different vocal styles. If you know how to push the air and where to push it and everything, you can sound nasally or high pitched or sharp in the front, you know, or you can sing from the down here, the diaphragm, or you can sing from the diaphragm, from the diaphragm like that, it's all rumbling down here. Or you can push it up here in the nose and sound like this. Hey, woo, 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 woo. It's because I can sing it through your nose, you know. And so you get all these different sounds and how you play with the air, really. It's all possible. It's all, you know, I jump around and stuff, but I'm just ragged. It's all, so I'm not accomplished. I'm not accomplished. You know, I'm a dilettante. But, you know, I could just kind of, you know, hide in the choir, so to speak. Maybe. where your mistakes are kind of smoothed over. And you help smooth over others' mistakes, because, you know, sometimes you're singing good, maybe they're not singing so good, so, and you kind of help carry one another, I guess. But I tend to take risks. I make mistakes as far as singing. I'll try anything. I'm not just content to just kind of plod along and, yeah, this is what I'm supposed to sing, and I'm gonna try something. And try sing Detson. I'm gonna try something. And, you know, maybe, yeah, sometimes it works. It's like, wow, very innovative. So I have a spirit of innovation, actually, to keep trying something different. Let me try this. And it makes, you know, it kind of, sometimes you stumble across something that's just really cool. And other times you sound pretty ragged, like you don't know what you're doing. I'm not afraid to sound like I don't know what I'm doing. You know, not too afraid. Because I know that I'll come across something pretty cool at some point, yeah. So, oh, that sounded great. Whoa. I haven't heard that before. How can you hear it if you don't try it? So hopefully my voice will like stop breaking. I don't know how to stop it. I do know hydrating is very important. If I keep drinking, then I'm able to, you know, sing better for sure. If your throat gets really dry and tired and dry, it starts breaking up. And so hydrate. Just hanging out, stalling out, stalling out on the stall out. That's all we're doing. We're just stalling out on the stall. Just make that your goal. I'm gonna stall out on the stall out. This is just how I feel right now. This is just a stalling out on the stall out. Don't frustrate yourself by thinking, well, I've got to be enlightened. Well, you know, let those who are able to be concerned about that, be concerned about it. You know, it doesn't bother them when they're not struggling with it. For me, well, I got to be enlightened. Okay, well, full stop in the wow. I'm already enlightened. So I flip it around and say, what do you mean? And I got to be enlightened. That's ridiculous. There's only enlightenment. Everyone's already enlightened. There's nothing needs to be enlightened at all. So, I look at it that way, and then the pressure dissipates. I'm able to dissipate the pressure of it. If you can't dissipate the pressure of that, then don't struggle with it. Just say, I'm stalling out the stall out. I'm stalling out the stall out. I'm hanging out with the garage band. Could I play in a spiritual garage band? Well, yeah, maybe. Yeah, if it sounds kind of raggedy, yeah, it's possible. I'd be an idiot, but I could maybe do a few good things to make it sound like something, maybe. I don't know. Not many people want to listen, though. I've already been through that experience of played in garage bands and a lot, and parties, and people there just hanging out. We're just jamming, and before too long, everybody's kind of just like, left the room. It's very humbling, but we didn't really care anyway. Whatever, we're having fun, but they didn't like it. They didn't really like it. Didn't sound, because you're having fun. You think it's great, but they didn't like it so much because they want something they can grab a hold of, like a song or something, and entertainment. They want to be entertained. But some did kind of hang out because they were kind of interested. Maybe they wanted to be in a garage band too, and they kind of seeing, this is how you do it, But we could have done a lot better, that is for sure. But we really did jam. We were really true jammers. I mean, we didn't tell each other what to play. Nobody told each other what to play. The drummer, the bass player, the keyboard, whatever. Nobody told each other what to play. We just started playing, and sometimes we'd fit it together in a groove, and sometimes not. I didn't say, hey, you got to play this part. You got to play this part. I'm playing this part here. No structure. We had no structure. GarageBand, no structure at all. We just all played whatever we felt like playing. And just kind of trust each other to do something decent. But I think it would have been better to do some singing and have songs and then have jams within the song, like the Grateful Dead, perfected that kind of. And we could have done that. I was just, an idiot. I didn't trust my singing. I didn't know I could sing. And I didn't really pay attention to it. So I couldn't really sing well at that point. I had no confidence, so it showed. But if you do a song and you can sing well, then jamming's okay. Like, okay, people, we're just going to dance, and we're kind of just, we're just off doing the Grateful Dead. So many people love the Grateful Dead. That's what they did. They just trust it, but under the jam, 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 jam. And then they pull back and then do the verse, the verses and the refrains and stuff, and then it's like, oh, there's a song there. Oh, okay. And people said, okay, we're listening to a song. That's great. But sometimes they jam for an hour on a song or something. And I never was into the Grateful Dead because I was doing my own jamming. But I understood it. I would jam for hours. Absolutely, we would. We might start off on Johnny Be Good and then jam for an hour on it. But we didn't sing it worth a darn. I should have taken charge more on that, somebody's got to take charge in a garage band. You just can't have anarchy there, because people just it turns them off at some point. Somebody's got to say, look, okay, yeah, we're gonna have some unstructuredness, but we're also gonna have some structure, and you're gonna sing this part, I'm gonna sing this part, and if you sound lousy, I'm gonna tell you to sound lousy. And we'll work on it, and we'll find a way to sound good. Okay, but so you got to give the people something. You got something that sounds good. Come on, that's harmonious. It can't just be all this freeform jazzy. It just completely, wow. Yeah, eventually, gotta give them a little something. So I was too, wasn't quite confident enough or something. Otherwise, we could have been really, I could have had a musical career. It could have been really good, actually. I mean, the musicianship was there, and but we didn't have the appeal because we didn't really structure it out a little bit enough to sound really good in terms of enough so that people would stick around for the next song, you know. And then you get the jam session there, and you get really unstructured and abstract, and they'd say, oh, that's kind of interesting. But then you got to have another song. Okay, we're going to do now this song and start with, ooh, this is the way, you know, I always dreamed it would be, the way that it is, oh, when you are holding me. And start the song, ooh, you know, ooh, and the song, the voices come in, and just people say, ah, something, I can't do it now, my voice is just, it's toast. But because I was singing this song a lot today, and nailing it, really, I can hear music, I was just nailing it, for the most part, powerfully, and singing it just great. You got to come in with something like that. People get them clapping and feel okay, you know, and there's something nice, it's beautiful, there's a nice groove here. And then, you know, you can go off and do a Grateful Dead sort of thing. As long as they feel we're going to come back to this. It's kind of like we're going on an adventure, but we know what we're coming back to. It starts this way, with a comfortable way, and then we're going on an adventure, and then we come back to it. So this is important. It's important. So, I don't know, pray for my voice. Jamyang Kansi Choki Lodo, your voice, please. Can I find my voice? Got 12 days to find my voice almost, or something like that, a feeling. Can I trust in it to be able to say, because it keeps getting worn out. But maybe that's a metaphor, I don't know. Here we are, we've made the 2:30 mark. Okay, wow. Piece of cake. Well, I can do two hours and 30 minutes as a piece of cake for me. That's something. But this is a little more of like a jam session thing. If there's a little more structure, it would be nice, you know, right? But I don't know. I've tried structuring it, and it hasn't quite worked. So you might even need somebody to be like the lead singer. Come along, some lead singer to come along and says, this is the song we're going to do, okay? And this is your part in the song, this is your part. And I say, yeah, okay, I can probably, you know, I'll work on that. And then, but you also get to freeform it too. Oh, okay, yeah, I go with that. Maybe it'll be like Al Jardine. You know, he's singing there and blending with everybody in the sense. He's a really good singer himself, but he doesn't do too many leads. He did Help Me Rhonda, and Cotton Fields, he did that one. Very, very nicely done. But he wasn't featured, so he just blended in very nicely. So maybe there's something like, hey, you know, putting the band together, and I can just kind of do a little tambourine or something, and little chorus, tambourine, and yeah, I mean, I'd be happy playing the tambourine and a little few rhythm instruments and sing a little bit and just kind of being with the band. Yeah, maybe I would really enjoy that, actually. Yeah, John Young, maybe could give you the tambourine. Give you the tambourine here, a little harmonica. A few little keyboards, maybe, or no, that's too much responsibility. But or just kind of a, you know, one of the singers just kind of is up there, like in the chorus, it's just ooh ah wah, ooh ah wah, ooh ah. Snap your fingers, do a few dance steps, and yeah, and okay, yeah. Let me work into the band in that way. Just give me a little role in the band. As long as I'm a part of the band, you know, that's cool. I'd be happy with that right now. Because what you're really scared is, like, yeah, you need to be the lead singer. Whoa. You'd say, oh, yeah, I want to be real important. But then he said, no, I think that's a little too important. I don't think I can handle that. Not now. But some minor little thing that there's, they always squeeze somebody in the band some way. So I'm praying, Johnny, squeeze me into your band, you know, squeeze me into your band some way, you know, whatever you want to do it, just squeeze me into the band. So I'm saying, oh yeah, I'm a member of the band. Oh really, you're part of the band? Oh yeah. What do you do? I say, well, yeah, I got some roles I do. Maybe just have acoustic guitar and you just like strumming chords, you know, nobody hears you, it's not even plugged in. Basic, you know, you're not plugged in. And then you can sing also, you know, and if you miss the chords, you know, it doesn't really matter. And nobody's hearing the guitar anyway. But then you can sing and it looks like you're playing an instrument. Oh yeah, I'm part of the band. They do stuff like that. They find ways for their buddies to be in the band, even if they're not that musical. They find a way, right? The real talented people say, yeah, yeah, I come on to my band because, you know, you kind of bring something to it. Bring an attitude to it. Bring some sort of confidence to it. So, yeah, I want you in the band. I want you in my band. Wow. I could be like asked to join the Beach Boys. Would you like to be in the Beach Boys? Well, huh? Yeah, I mean, as long as you like, hide me somewhere. If you hide me real good, I can get up there. Yeah, this is the way I always dreamed it would be. The way that it is. Oh, when I'm holding you, I never had love of my own. Maybe that's why when we're all alone, I can hear music. I can hear music. You know, just like da 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 gestures, you know, like da 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 da. Whoa, and dun dun. And just, you know, groove to the music. Maybe I could just learn to groove to the music. You know, one of these people in the band that are just kind of there to groove to it. And everybody, that kind of helped the audience. Yeah, it's okay to groove to it. You know, kind of like that. Maybe I can do that. And at some point you get confident, maybe you find your voice and you get confident enough to, you know, maybe give a little vocal part or something, I don't know, possible, I'm not really worried about, but maybe I could just help the audience groove to it. I mean, that maybe that's what I can do, because that's kind of what I've been training for, you know, is just to be able to kind of have this capability to, like, to groove to it, yeah, like that. That's what Mike loved it. He didn't play an instrument. He sang great vocals. He's a great vocalist, actually. Very underrated. But he just kind of grooved to it and kind of showed the audience, like, you know, yeah, you can kind of groove to it this way. he's a front man, you know, groovy. But the heavy lifting was been done by the musicians. But you know, he did heavy lifting singing, that's for sure. All right, so getting somewhere. I'm going to help the audience groove to the band. Clap, yeah, and maybe a little chorus, you know, sing a little chorus, ooh. even my chorus is not good, right? My voice is very fragile right at the moment. I have to push it. I've been pushing it to get the high sound. You really have to push it. It's difficult. Wears your voice out. It's much easier to sing low like this, you know, from Honky Tonk, yeah, What Goes Wrong. I can hit those that a lot easier. The higher stuff, really have to push strong, push it. And it, but that wears your voice out. Interesting. Or do it real gently, and then you can hit the higher notes and stuff. But if you sing gently, that's another way to sing very gently. I can do that too. I can belt, I can sing gently. Could do all of that. You know, get worn out too. That's another thing. So, this is a metaphor. I'm using a metaphor for a spiritual band, of course. It's a metaphor for a spiritual band. Can I join a spiritual band? Can I join Jamyang's spiritual band? It's like he's putting a band together. It's like, I'm putting the band together. I need you. I want you in the band. I need you in the band. Not just want, I need you in the band. What? Well, I'm going to be a roadie or something, maybe. But. Okay, let me just snap my fingers and look like I'm cool or something, yeah. I'm cool. This is cool. Come on, everybody. Let's get with the coolness of this, man. Let's stall out on the stall out. Here, we're going to stall out on the stall out. Yeah. And people are starting to see me that way. They see me in a different light now, everybody. I noticed that. Some people like pat me on the back, you know, and I'm patting them. And I walked in the store and says, oh, here comes the car guy, you know. And I just started this little groove. I did this walk, like, groove. They all kind of laughed. I said, yeah. And they sort of like, oh, here comes this super hip guy. You know, it's like, oh, everybody's like, oh, here comes this super hip guy in the store. Like, what's he going to do? You know, is he going to like, you know, he's going to do something that's like, makes us laugh. Like he's like a guy. You know, here comes this guy. It's funny because it was in the store and we were interacting. This other guy was in there, and he's like, they all know him. Like, here's this guy, you know, and he has a Superman shirt on with Superman on his shirt. Like, whoa! And he's interacting with me, and we're laughing and stuff. It's like we both feel like, hey, we're both two guys, you know. Actually, kind of he recognized like, hey, you're kind of a hip guy too, aren't you? I am too. I said, yeah, I see you are. And so like two hip guys, and the people are kind of recognizing, there's two hip guys here. Like we're both in the band. We're hip enough to be in the band. We're super hip enough to be in the band. So, but the hipness that we have to have in this band is super hipness. Super hipness. So I have a little bit of super hipness maybe. Apparently. Not really good at it. But maybe, you know, apparently I have a little bit of super hipness now, which is really where we're at. You know, I'm a super hippie. As I said, the hippie thing is not coming back, really. Okay, but what it's now turned into is super hippiness. Okay, so be a super hippie at this point. Be a super hippie. We're not reprising, you know, the 60s. It's not coming back. We're not doing a musical bringing the 60s back. Exactly, really. But it's super hip now. We're super hipness, super hip. We're stalling out on the stall out, and what is more hip than that, right? Enlightenment. We're already every. What do you mean enlightenment? What? What are you talking about? Has there ever been unenlightenment for anyone ever? Has anyone ever experienced what's not here? Not here-ness? No, but nobody's ever experienced this. I mean, let's just celebrate this fact. I mean, this is super hipness. Why don't we just celebrate the fact that nothing's ever been stuck? There's never been any problem at all. Let's start celebrating that. Now, yeah, I could, you know, maybe I have it in something in me. I don't know. Maybe I can raise my arms. Come on, everybody, raise your arms. Yeah, yeah. Come on. Yeah, it's like, maybe a little bit, then maybe you get, but, you know, a little bit of time and you start building your confidence up. And then you wow it. You have to keep wowing it, keep wowing it, keep wowing it. Wow, that really, wow, didn't go over well. Wow, isn't this super wowish that, you know, just see it that way as a wow. Just the very fact that you saw that didn't go over very well in the series, that's very wowish. Like, I was an idiot. Oh, but I saw that. I saw that I'm an idiot. I see it. So what do I need to do not to be such an idiot? Oh, I can see that now. Okay. Wow. So if you just, as long as you keep wowing it, be humble enough to keep wowing your moment by moment by moment, that's being super hip, actually. That's how you be super hip. So I'm kind of a super hippie at this point. And John Young says, hey, super hippie, you know. I need you, come on. I need all the super hippies I can get. Okay, right, okay, where's my tambourine? And people are talking about, I was at the store, the people talk about deer's jumping out. Somebody said, I just hit one last week. Someone else, I just have one jumping out, jump in front of me. Deers are jumping out in front of people all over the place here. It's crazy. It's like, it's really dangerous. Manias are, you know, jumping out all over the place. Manias are coming. So, you know, I'm like super hip. Nothing seems to faze you. You know, all that they say, they go to church and the priest says, yeah, we're praying for the people of this place and praying for the people of this place and praying for this. And I said, what are they talking about? I don't know. I don't know what they're talking about. I don't pay attention to the news. So, I mean, I'm not down. I don't get down on, you know, I'm not on a downer right now. You can't, super hippie, can't, it's not on a downer. So, yeah, well, whatever happens, happens. But if, who's stuck and what's, and how can anyone be stuck on what's not really here? What's not here now? So everything's just a convention that we're stuck. Are we stuck in all these issues? No, we've never been stuck. So if we're not stuck, yeah, what's the problem? There isn't any problem. Except the continuity fear. So let's go to work and evaporate it. We do that through super hypnosis. So let's just go to work on it. That's all. It's only one problem. This is not two problems. There's only one problem. What the heck? 244 again. This is playing tricks on me or something. I was just at 230. How did I get to 244? I just looked at it. It was 230. How did 14 minutes just elapse? This is really strange. Wow. Well, being super hip, I guess. That's what happens when you're super hip. Collapsing time, somehow. So, what do you do if you're not really super hip yet? Or you feel like, yeah, just like in the hippie, I was on the fringes of the hippie movement sort of thing. I said, I'm not really a hip yet, you know, I'm not really a hippie yet. So I kind of hung out. I never was a real hippie, actually. I was always kind of fringe. I wasn't hip enough. You know, really, I wasn't. Some of these hippies were really hip. There's no question about it. They were really into it. They had, you know, the hippie women and the hippie men. They were into each other and being hippiness, and they were really into it. And they were living it. But I never went quite that far with it, actually. But I hung around it all. So, but that's okay. So you might say, well, I'm not quite super hip. I don't quite have that confidence, you know. If Jam Yong says, hey, I want you in my band, I just, I'm not quite there yet. He's not going to ask you, really, if you're not super hip anyway. But so you may just kind of be like coming to the concert and listening to the band, which I did. You know, I didn't, maybe having a garage band, and so you're into it. You're into the scene. I mean, you're kind of into the scene, but you're not, you realize, I don't think I can really be someone who's in the band yet. Okay, well, do that. That's great. It's not exactly easy to be super hip. You have to be, you know, really, you have to have this inner discipline that's just, you've lived it. Not intellectualized, lived it. I've lived this. I've lived the discipline. I've lived the practice. I've been really into it, not just thinking or intellectualizing or fantasizing, but actually doing it. And so that's the difference. That's the big difference. I just went all in. You know, just doing it. So, I mean, I'm going to tape, and not think about taping. I'm not going to sit in my room thinking about it. I'm going to do it. Because what else do I have to do? I'm going to be either an idiot, or I'm going to go all in. Sitting in your room thinking about doing something isn't doing it. So I feel tired. I'm going to tape. I've got something important to say. I've got a job. I've got a responsibility. I've got to do it. So you live it. And if you live it, then that's what the hippies did. They lived it. They went all in. I respected the heck out of them for that, you know. It's like, wow, you guys and gals, you know, are really, really something. I said, I wish I could be like that, you know, but I'm not old enough. I don't have the money. I don't have the skills. I mean, they had survival skills. They were out on their own. They're traveling in Nepal. You know, I just like blew my mind. Really, I just looked up to them, you know, and just said, wow. I mean, they were traveling all over the world by themselves and funding on nothing. Well, some of them had trust funds, let's be honest, and some of them had, you know, their parents helped them out, and some of them had jobs, but some of them could just work. They said, I can work and work my way. They worked their way around the world, places, different places. They made friends. They networked. They just did it. They were fearless. The hippies were fearless. And I was just this kid in the suburbs. I had all this fear. I couldn't do that. I really couldn't. So I just, you know, I wasn't really part of Woodstock Nation, because they were so fearless and independent and stuff, and I was just hanging out in a garage, playing, you know, jamming in a garage or something, reading spiritual books and trying to see if I could be hip someday. I said, maybe someday I can be hip, but I don't really feel like I am. Now, you know, I feel a little hip, super hip. I mean, I feel a little super hip, maybe. Not much. I guess meeting, you know, John Myung, Kenzie Chokey Lodro, that's a little bit of super hipness right there. Meeting Longchenpa, a little bit of super hipness right there. Meeting these Dharma kings, I guess people would say that's pretty super hip. I guess, I mean, if I put myself in others' shoes, it's like I was looking up to the hippies of that time and saying, wow, they're really something. You know, if some people might be looking up to me and say, wow, it's really something to actually, you know, have contact with John Myung, Kenzie Chokey Lodro, that's really something. You know, that's wow. It's really wowish. You know, but for me, you know, it's just like, well, you know, this is what I do. I mean, I just wow it. You know, this is what happens. What do I do? Well, I wow it. So I don't break my stride. You know, I'm just really into not breaking my stride. I take everything in stride. If, you know, Jesus shows up, I take it in stride. Yeah, I met Jesus. And it's okay. I met Jesus. Now let's wow this. You know, this is okay. And so I just know I'm going to be practicing every day so I don't get too, you know, I don't get all panicky or freaked out or, you know, just, you know, the professional freak is you don't get freaked out. The freak is back. In other words, you just keep your stride. So yeah, I mean, if Jesus showed up right now, it's okay. Wow. It's a big wow. Just gotta, you know, nothing I can do except wow it. What else is there to do? Could be very determined. You know, you're just not gonna think about it, not gonna do anything except wow it. And this is, you know, just wow, and my continuity fear is gonna rise. I know that, so I got a problem. Just evaporate it. Just work on evaporating it. What else can I do? I know what to do because there's nothing else to do. So being super hip means you know what to do. It's like those hippies, they seem to know what to do. They seem to know what to do to be a hippie. For me, I know what to do to be a super hippie, which is this practice. You know, continuity fear is going to arise. You got to wow it. You got to evaporate. You got to flip the script. And you just have to keep do it. That's all. So I know what to do. So I'm not really too, you know, freaked out by, and I'm not worried about what might happen as far as, you know, something super hip as well. You know what, you know, I'm not exactly, you know, thrilled by it. You know, like I get really strongly wowed. It's stressful. Yeah, I mean, it's very stressful, but I'm not like panicky about it. Except if Sri Sri Anandamayi Maha showed up, that might be a different story. Yeah, not quite yet. I don't know if I could ever handle that one, actually. That's why I try not to think about it. Because she's just, you know, so off the charts. You know, I don't even know, you know, I don't even know if you could even wow that, actually. Just enough to see her picture. It's so wowish. She's just like, wow, I can't even take this, you know. It's just ridiculous. Yeah, it's just spend all day just a glimpse is enough to wow me for, you know, for a week. You know, it's a little too powerful. Yeah, really. So, but you know, okay, she shows up. I just have to wow. What else can I do? You know, that's a tough one though. Yeah, it's gonna be a tough one. I just have to be ferociously focused on wowing it, if that ever happened. This is someone that's never been anyone. Yeah, she's never been anyone. I mean, how do you relate to that? I mean, it's not like, oh, I was this really important historical figure. Really, no, she's never been anyone. Never had any karma at all. Never involvement in any karma whatsoever. Just fresh as a daisy, you know. It's like, that's pretty wowish, isn't it? Yeah. So, anyway, I know what to do. Is you just have to wow it, but it would be a pretty stressful wow, that's for sure. So, you know, we have all-star evening here, and I'm taping for 3 hours. Okay, that's what I do. So I didn't just think about it. So yeah, it'd be really cool to tape instead of watch the All-Star game. It'd be really cool to tape. Let me just turn the All-Star game on, just watch a little bit, and then maybe, you know, I'll watch a little bit, then I'll get to taping. Oh, it's a pretty interesting game, you know. Maybe I'll tape after the game. Yeah, I can do that. Oh, and I'm tired. It's a really exciting game. I'm kind of tired. It's getting late. Shoot. Maybe I can tape a little bit. Nah, because I'm not really sure what I'm going to say, you know. Right? Before you know it, opportunity gone. Opportunity gone. Like, you can't do that. If you want to be super hip, you can't miss your opportunities. So I said, no, not even a thought of watching it. I'm going to tape, and I'm going to hit it hard. I'm going to work out. I'm going to hit it hard. And that's all there is to it. You know, this is 12 days till the 24th. No, I'm not going to fool around right now. At least best I can. You know, pray not to get sidetracked and take it just one step at a time here, that's all. People are relating to me different because I'm relating to them different. I'm kind of sort of a super hip thing. I'm doing stuff that is out of the norm for people. Out of the norm. I could have done something today. I felt like it. There's some homeless person that was asking for money, and they walk in the line of cars, and they walk. By the time I saw him, they'd walk past me, and I couldn't get his attention. He walked far down the line, and I had something to give him. And I said, so what do I do? I could have just got out of the vehicle and walked over and just set it where he would go back to. And I should have done it, but I didn't do it because maybe the light's going to turn green. But I could have done it really fast. You know, I could put my car in park, jump out, run over there, you know. But you don't see people doing that. So I said, nobody does that. But I said, I could do it, but I didn't do it. I was like, that's stupid. Why didn't I just do that? So that's something in my mind right now. Maybe next time I'll just get out of my vehicle and just, you know, hop over there. I mean, I got the hops for it. I'm quick like a cat. You know, I can move like a cat right now, actually. So why don't I just do that? Yeah, why not? So I'm trying to be more alert for those kind of situations. And if there's a homeless person, give them something. Whatever. You know, whatever you got. You got a little bit of money. Somebody was there, a young guy, gave him something. So it's really cool. And he had his window open, and he's looking at me, and he said, I don't know. He kind of said to me, he's gone. He's down there. I don't know what I can do. I said, yeah, okay, thanks. I saw he gave him something. He's not rich. He's a poor guy. I could tell. It's usually the poor people that give other poor people money because they know what it's like. Rich people, they can't relate. Just can't relate. Why doesn't he get a job? Why doesn't he earn money like I have money? They can't relate. If you're poor, you can relate. I mean, I'll give some of my last dollar, you know, because I've been down to $0, nothing, many times. I'm always almost at zero, actually. So I know what it's like. It's no fun at all. It's terrible. You know, just let somebody know, hey, here's a dollar, man. I mean, it's better than nothing, right? Here's a start. You know, don't give up on yourself. We're not giving up on you. You're your Dharma king. We're all Dharma kings, actually. We just don't. We're just looking for what's not a Dharma king. You know, I'm a Dharma king. No, but I'm trying to find something that's not a Dharma king. That's what we are. We're all Dharma kings, but we're trying to see. But you know, what is not a Dharma king about me? I'm trying to find that. In other words, I'm trying to find something outside of reality. I'm trying to find another reality. This is our whole trouble. But we're all perfect Dharma kings right now. Inescapably so. Inescapably so. inescapably so. There's no escape from it. You're trying to escape from it. There's no escape. Yeah, I don't know. Got to just start doing some more skipping rope and jumping on one leg. I think I'm going to try that. I think that's the next thing I'm headed towards, is one leg hopping. I had done some of that. Just hop, 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 hop. Wow. If you want to know if you're in shape, just see how far you can hop on one leg. Okay? And that'll give you a report card right there. How you doing? How far can you hop? I'm gonna hop up the stair. Hop upstairs on one leg. I never tried that. I think I might. Never tried it. But, you know, at some point I may just say, I'm going to try hopping up one stair and two stairs. Let me try these three stairs. Hop, hop. Can I do it on one leg? I don't know. Or I can probably try it on two legs and maybe hop up stairs on two legs. Or can I do it on one leg? So get very hoppy. The Holy Spirit wants us to be very hoppy, at least me. Hoppy, happy, hoppy. If we can't be happy, let's be at least hoppy. And so we could be hippie. Hippie, happy, hoppy. A happy, hoppy, hippie. I'll be a happy, hoppy, super hippie. Be a happy, hoppy, super hippie. Happy, happy, super hippie, happy, hoppy, super hippie, happy, hoppy. There's a mantra. I am a happy, hoppy, super hippie Dharma King. I am a happy, happy, super hippie Dharma King right here now. Because there isn't anywhere else to be. I am being. I am already, I am completely being. Everyone's being. Everything's being. There's only being. We're not being. There's only being. What else is there? Come on. It's not like being and not being. Where's the not being? I haven't found it yet. Nobody's found it. Nobody's found it. What, we hit the big 3-0? We hit the big 3-0, haven't we? I don't know where what happened here. It's just we're at the big 3-0. It's past midnight, actually. How is this all possible? I don't know. Be a hoppy, happy, super hippie Dharma King right here, right now. I'm already that. And one insight settled it all. One insight did indeed settle it all for me. So again, if you can't quite be the, you're like, it's like, I'm not quite ready to be in the band. I'm just got a guitar. I'm just trying to practice it. I can't quite be in the lead guitars in the band or something. But still, you know, just hang out and stall out on the stall out. One insight has indeed settled it all. One insight did indeed settle it all. One insight did indeed settle it all. One insight did indeed settle it all. Believe in that. Believe it. It's true. It's true. Believe in the truth. How hard is it to believe in the truth? Just say, yeah, there's something about it, the fragrance. I'm attracted to it. I just want to hang out for a while. Maybe later I'll stall out, but right now I'm stalling out on the stall out. Maybe later I'll stall out, but right now I'm stalling out on the stall out. Maybe later I'll stall out, yeah, but right now I'm stalling on the stall out. Just like that. This is the way I always dreamed it would be. The way that it is when I'm stalling out searching for not, how not to be. I'm stalling out on searching for how not to be. Yeah. This is how I dreamed it would be when I stall out looking for how it's not, how being is not to be. This is the way I always dreamed it would be. Great. So this is the way I always dreamed it would be. You say, this is the way I always dreamed it would be. This is exactly the way I always dreamed it would be. One insight has indeed settled it all. This is exactly the way I always dreamed it would be. Say that. This is exactly the way that I always dreamed it would be. This is the way I always dreamed it would be. I can hear music by the Beach Boys. A very cool song, actually. Yeah, it's kind of put in a romantic context, but you can pull it out of that one. But it's just got this sort of this big wall of sound, like it's filling up spacious. It's like spaciousness. There's spaciousness to it. Very, very nice. Gets me going. As soon as I hear that song, I start clapping in the vehicle. I'm just like, I'm gonna hit this one. going to hit it. I'm going to hit it. It's going to hit me. Yeah, it's going to hit me hard. Well, at some point, I got to stop the video. So I got to wind it down. Lose my inspiration here. Otherwise, I'll keep going. When you're on fire, why not keep burning? So, yeah, we really hit it hard here. It hit us hard, too. This is the way I always dreamed it would be. Stalling out on the stall out. One insight has indeed settled it all for me. This is the way I always dreamed it would be. One insight has indeed settled it all for me. This is the way I always dreamed it would be. One insight has indeed settled it all for me. Da 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 da. Maybe that's why when we're all alone, I can hear music. Sounds of the city, baby, seem to disappear. So the sounds of fear, confusion, despair, depression, hope and fear, you know, all those sounds of the thoughts and concepts, everything, they seem to disappear. This is the way I always dreamed it would be. When one insight did indeed settle it all for me. Okay, this is the way I always dreamed it would be. When one insight did indeed settle it all for me. It's exactly what I've always dreamed about. It's exactly what I've always dreamed about. It's exactly what I've always dreamed about. Okay, I better. Settle it all right now. Settle it all right now. This is how one insight did indeed settle it all. And that's it for now.